Live from the Toadhop Network Studios
in Hollywood,
this
is the ToadhopNetwork.com.
A place of our own without a lot of parents peering down our backs.
Radio worth watching.
And here we go.
Nice.
Did this for Ellis, he's not even listening.
That's right, it is the Schmoes No Movie Show, the last live show for a little bit. We'll get into that in just a bit. It's me, Christian Harloff.
And I am TV's Mark Ellis.
Not yet, you're not.
I am. Here's what's going on, Christian, is that, like, we've both been on TV a lot. We've done commentary, I've acted, I've done stand-up, I've been on TV a lot.
I like that. Good
so
credits,
last
good
night
credits.
It was so nice to get a break from being on national television. It was so nice to just kick back
sure
and not
was.
Worry about what I look like on TV that day. God, it was a nice, just relaxing weekend for me. How was yours?
It was pretty good. And the little subliminal talk that Ellis is doing, we'll talk about that soon. But I want to...
Tiffany looks good today.
Tiffany does look good. Tiffany usually looks really good, but she did herself up tonight, and she looks like Erin Darling. Erin, how are you?
Oh, my God. I'm great. How are you guys doing?
Erin
nice
Darling's in
back.
Studio.
Yay!
You hump spot for
her. Erin Darling will be from Clever Movies and AMC Movie Talk. She is going to be with us for, our last live show on the Toadhop Network, and we're going to talk about that. If you did not listen last week, we'll kind of fill you in on what's going on with that in just a second. But, Erin, so what's new? What's the latest?
Let's see. Things are going awesome at AMC. Got some exciting stuff going on over there. I don't know if I can talk about yet. So hopefully I'll have something cool to tell you guys in a couple of weeks. And I am so honored to be here for the last one at the Toad Hop for a while.
Yeah. All right. So let's talk about that. So for those of you who were like, wait, last show. It's not the last show. And someone said, what? Toad Hop doesn't want them anymore?
No. Toad Hop loves us. They're going to miss us. We're going to miss them for a little bit.
But we're not leaving them, though. Yeah. That's the thing. Here's the thing with Toad Hop. They are not producing shows anymore. They're just distributing shows for the time being. And so what we're going to do, again, our show will be on, when you go Thursday nights, you go and listen, and you can still listen to the show. If you go, and again, you'll be able to tweet in the same way. We're going to be back and forth. We'll be listening to it, going back and forth, and tweeting with you guys as stuff is going on. And with phone calls, too, we'll let you know when we're broadcasting. Let's say we tape a show, because we're working now with Drama 3-4, and we're going to talk about that in a little bit, too, in our new sketch division that we started.
Yeah, the bottom line is that you're still going to get the Schmoes No Movies podcast every Thursday night, 8 to 9 p.m. All right, this is it. It's because our engineer, Johnny, he likes nipping the sauce. It's Monday, and you're hitting the ball. You look like a South Park character with no hat on.
Yeah, it's true. It's true. Now listen, so what's going on now with Drama 3-4 is a fantastic production company, and we're going to be shooting a bunch of sketches. We actually shot one with them. We're going to be doing a live event with them. We'll talk about that in a little bit.
Man, did we have a ball with those Drama 3-4 kids this weekend.
And how great they are. They have now given us their offices to do the podcast, and we will be running the Schmoes No Network podcast from there as well. And here's another tweet, Mark, that someone had tweeted, like, so wait a minute, so it's just going to be, they're not going to do the big show anymore? Yes. Everybody in this room, and Tiffany included, are going to be doing the big show still.
Yeah,
live show.
I can speak for the rest of the crew of the podcast. These guys have nothing better to do than to
right.
Follow us to the ends of the earth. We couldn't shake these guys if we were broadcasting from Barstow. They'd find a way to get there. So
that's
you
right.
Get all your crazy. Ken's still going to be the producer wearing his suit. Josh McCougar's still going to be the wild man drinking, killing livers left and right.
Even though they've doppelganged, they've changed bodies.
Yeah,
tonight.
No, I hate you so much, Ken Knapp.
I was wise to that.
Look at Ken is dancing in the background like McCougar usually does. And I said Ken is probably a better dancer.
Yeah, but I couldn't see.
Those moves are solid.
Those are solid moves.
I couldn't see McCougar wearing what Ken looks like. Jack Bauer, like when he's undercover a little bit, you know? You got to have pockets just in case.
Right. So, okay. And again, here's the other thing I want everybody to know. The iTunes feed that you have for Schmoes No Movies, that's not changing. They'll all be updated same way as before. And the other thing is, if you look on iTunes and you go for Schmoes No Network, that's where you're going to find shows such as The Wild Man Show, Wild Man Josh McCuga will have his own show. Ken Napstock will have his own show. Riley will have his own show. What? Finstock will have his own show. I will have my own show. And I wasn't able to announce on Thursday who that is with. Now I can tell everybody that it's going to be with Bonnie Somerville.
So
I will have my own show with Bonnie.
Wow.
And then who knows what the hell you're going to have. You'll have a show as well. But that's what I'm saying. There's a lot of possibilities out there.
If I do it with a blonde, it's not going to be with Bonnie Somerville. Erin, how are you?
Good to see you. Look at you.
Honored to be your first choice or second. What was that?
You get a medal. If this was the Olympics, you'd have
second
because
Bonnie's taken. It's all right. Top five. It's okay.
No, it's on air. You're the first.
Yeah, trust me. In no way does Bonnie even enter this Olympics.
Okay.
No, I love Bonnie.
So that's it. So if you have any questions about that, make sure you subscribe to the Schmoes No Network feed. Stay here. Leave comments, rate, and all that stuff. And when let's say we broadcast on like a Wednesday.
Mm-hmm.
If we do that, we're going to tape an episode of the live of the big show. We'll tell all you guys, and you guys can tweet in, and we're going to try to. We're just going to set it up with the Skype and everything, to where you guys can call in as well.
Yeah, but we'll read your guys' tweets on air. We'll do all the stuff, so it's going to feel a lot like the normal show. And again, for you, this isn't really going to be that hard for you, the viewer. All you do is you tune into Toadhop like you always have on Thursdays. And again, no, you haven't been doing too much meth. It is a Monday tonight.
Mm-hmm. And then what about Sunday? And then Sunday, because again, Makuga's going to be lending us his camera, so we will be able to shoot the whole show and put that up on YouTube on Sunday.
Okay, but do we have to tell him it's Makuga's shit? Why can't we just say, hey, we have cameras that we're using?
And here's another big announcement.
Because Mark, I'm right here.
Yeah, that's right.
Why do you have to put your name on everything? You know?
I've got a label baby junior, okay?
And there's something that we floated around to.
You've changed since you've been in the suit, you know that?
You know what else has changed?
Huh.
The moniker of JTI.
No!
JTI might change.
Why?
Depending on the network. And if he learns, Ken is going to be training him, he could become JTE.
JTE.
And that would be Joshy Engineer, because he's going to be taking over for
look at Ice just
Johnny Ice is getting... Well, Johnny, face off.
Showdown.
Cops are totally blew that camera opportunity. Way to go. So cops, for that reason alone, you will still be the intern. Now the other thing we have to talk about, Mark, last night. We're going to get into... Craig Brewer is going to be here tonight, by the way.
Great director.
Hustle & Flow, the Footloose remake, and we cannot wait to talk to him. We're going to be talking about the upcoming releases that are coming out this week as well. Mm-hmm. And Kellen Coleman, really funny actress that came in last time. Yeah, she's from the show The Newsroom. She's going to be the bachelorette in the Celebrity Impression Dating Game.
And we should tell everybody this right now, because one of the podcast crew here is really, really sweet on this broad.
My life has led up to this one moment.
Yeah, and you're not, Josh, I'm going to try to do this gently. You're not a perennial favorite when it comes to the Celebrity Impression Dating Game.
No, not lately. Yeah, he was like... Out of the gate, he was like the guy you wanted to be.
I was like Fernando Valenzuela in his first two seasons.
You know what you are?
Like
when you can make eye contact with the contestant, you're like Peyton Manning in a dome.
Sure.
When you can't look at him, you're like Peyton Manning in the cold, and that ball just flutters, and that impression just goes right out
of
the stage.
It's like Rookie of the Year. They had that arm thing, and then it just blew out, and you can't do anything
about it. I keep trying to do like the Statue of Liberty play on a baseball diamond.
Yep. All right, so let's talk.
Doubt me, guys, doubt me.
Let's talk about some more doubt, and that was last night's episode that we were not in of the Drama Queen.
God, what an entertaining hour that was.
Listen.
Oh, my God.
Listen. So
I laughed. I cried.
I cried because I thought we were supposed to be in. We told Schmoville. Look, everybody that has been on this show tweeted it out and got people excited about it, talking about it. Hey, the Schmoes are going to be on this show, the Drama Queen. And we were told that we were going to be in the last 10 minutes of this episode. So apparently what happened was in the cut before the final cut, we were in the show.
Okay,
and
good.
Then they moved us to the entire episode 3.
Without telling us, when they had already told us, hey, make sure you let your fans know to watch the Drama Queen, because you guys are going to be on TV. And so, my God, we told them to watch, and Schmoville just flooded the gates.
They broke Twitter.
Schmoville was trending. Drama Queen was trending because of Schmoville's support.
Yes, you guys literally grabbed hands and stormed the castle. It was like, it was so cool. I can't tell you, my wife was like, aren't you watching? I'm like, no, I'm overwhelmed with like the support that Schmoville is doing right now on Twitter. I can't keep up. And thank you guys. And I'm so bummed that, you know, we weren't on it, because literally Ellis and I were like, what would have happened the way that they were tweeting last night if when we would have showed up? Like, you know, they would have went bananas. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so I'm really hoping that everybody comes back on Sunday, our third episode, that you guys can do the same thing, because that was a lot of fun doing all that tweeting.
Yeah, we're definitely in it. We heard from Dr. Claw at E that we're definitely going to be in this episode this Sunday.
That's
so the powers that be have told us that. And if not, hey, you still get to watch our manager play tennis and all of our underlings get in a fight for an hour. So, hey, entertainment for everybody.
Right. All right. So, again, so next week on Sunday.
I'm a little heated, Christian. I apologize.
I know. I get it. 11 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Check out the Drama Queen. We're going to be on there. We're giving away all those Blu-rays and stuff that we didn't give away last night. We'll give away more of Ellis's comedy CDs. We're going to give away some posters. Yeah, we're going to give away a lot of cool stuff. So make sure you go back on Sunday, and we'll do that all over again next week.
The Drama Queen, 11 p.m. EST. Hashtag Drama Queen.
That's right. Now, something you might notice that's different. Is there, Johnny, can we get rid of that one stupid thing on the screen?
Yeah, why is there a DOS?
What is that? All right, so if you're looking in the screen
right
now,
that always scared me in computer class.
That is not Ken Knapsack in the suit.
It is not.
And I believe the only reason he's wearing a suit is Kellen Coleman is coming in. But if that's not the case, I don't know, he's producing this show tonight. But Ken shows up, and when Josh, how'd you feel when Ken shows up right as you're about?
Upset. Not gonna lie.
He threw his hands up in the air. He's like, "Oh, come on!"
Yeah.
I wrote out the news. Mm-hmm. I put a suit on. I had to dust this thing off. I don't really dress up a lot. You know, everybody knows this. I'm a jeans and t-shirt kind of guy. Ken shows up like Ron Swanson hunting in his cabin on Parks and Rec. And
I have to tell you, after this whole thing with you in the suit, Ken realizing he doesn't have to do the news or produce. I've known Ken for over 10 years. I have never seen him more relaxed. He looks so happy. There's life in his face.
Now what if Josh gets hurt halfway through reading the news? What if he rips an ACL or something? Is Ken gonna step in?
I don't think Ken would move an inch. I think Ken
would
be
just watch him suffer.
He would just stay there and say, "Look, I told you I did not do writing at all." And so here's the thing: Josh McCouga is going to do the news tonight.
Mm-hmm. Wild man,
that is a tough act to follow.
It sure is. I got to tell you, I was full of anxiety today.
I'm sure
really
you were.
Really
like
was.
You're a guy that's got a lot of personality. You're smart. You know your movies.
Thanks,
you know your movies and your TVs.
I do.
But let's not fuck around.
I know.
Ken Knapsack is the best there is, the best there was, and the best there ever will be.
I've seen McCouga like play pretty cool under pressure, but right now he looks like the nervous best
man
at a wedding. Yeah. You know, like, oh my God, her whole family doesn't like me. This is I wrote some jokes in here that are questionable.
Yeah, it's like you're working on your set, your jokes have been going pretty good, you're making like 20 people laugh, and then you have to follow Chris Rock.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, so good luck.
But without further ado.
That being said, let's start the news.
I also feel like tonight I might be successful with women. For once.
All right, let's get the news started. No, that's not it.
This isn't my music.
Yeah, that's a Ken
I
Knapsack.
Don't know this.
Good God, that's Ken Knapsack's music.
Okay.
Thank you.
Appreciate that. All right, here we go. I'm Josh McCouga summoning in for Ken the Pit Boss Knapsack, and these are your Schmoes No headlines. Like an episode of Sons of Anarchy without Jack saying, "Jesus Christ, no Schmoes No podcast news segment would be complete without mentioning Star Wars casting." Apparently, the rewrites with Lawrence Kasdan and J.J. Abrams have been going according to plan. The script is totally different, and the first draft can also be used as a hat. An older casting breakdown said to be looking for a 30 to 40-something male military type has been re-released and turned into a much bigger role. 12 Years a Slave star Chiwetel Ejiofor, good luck pronouncing that one, JTI, is said to be the apple of JJ's eye, along with possible contenders Benedict Slumbermuch and Jason Fleming. Ejiofor, well known as an actor with chops and the guy who married Keira Knightley in Love Actually, is coveted by producers so he can get Episode 7, that much-needed gravitas. Sorry, Gallagher, I know Lucas still owes you a favor, but not this time. On a side note, I'd like to let everyone know that I have no idea who's winning the fantasy draft, but my Gina Carano pick is still on the table. In some who really cares, I'd rather have another Facebook than Spider-Man movie news, Sony announced that the Amazing Spider-Man 2 trailer will screen before The Hobbit, The Desolation of Smaug. Along with Captain America 2, really? This guy again? And X-Men Days of Future Past, the old dudes are back, bitches. Obviously, this is the only reason to go see dwarves, hobbits, and elves all getting along in the sandbox of Middle-earth to fight one common enemy, a dragon, guarding gold we all none of those little fellows will swim in like Scrooge McDuck. The TASM2 trailer, yes, they're using that acronym, will also be available online a week before The Hobbit is released after a segment on Good Morning America. So again, I'd just like to say the trailer
trailer for The Amazing Spider-Man 2. It's not Tobey Maguire, but the guy from Facebook with the great hair will be screening before the new Hobbit movie. The newest Day of the Dead remake has found itself a director. Who is it, you may ask? His name is Mark Tondereai, and his biggest credit to date is a little movie you may have heard of called Little House on the... No, wait. Fox's... What? Oh, no, sorry. I meant The House at the End of the Street, a.k.a. Oh. Hey, look at Jennifer Lawrence's boobs and this wife beater, which may or may not get wet. The Day of the Dead hopes to ride the coattails of the immensely popular series The Walking Dead, but like the remake from 5 years ago, we could be looking at a straight-to-DVD release. But hey, Journey Live in Houston went straight-to-DVD, and we all know how that DVD ended up.
Goddamn right we do.
The Day of the Dead is looking to start production in the summer of 2014 along with Disney's Bears. Sorry, I had to do that. It was announced today that actor Aaron Taylor Johnson, famous for his turn in Kick-Ass and, of course, Albert Nobbs, and actress Elizabeth Olsen has been cast in Avengers 2 Age of Ultron. Olsen and ATJ will play the siblings Quicksilver and Scarlet Witch. Their origins will be altered because 20th Century Fox owns the film rights to the characters who also live in the X-Men world. If that's not confusing enough, they're also starring in Godzilla together. And Elizabeth Olsen is Mary Kate and Ashley's sister. And Ultron is just a giant tin man, right? In the X-Men brand, Quicksilver is super fast, creative, and Scarlet Witch is a redheaded tramp who broke my heart in the 10th grade. Being that the superhero version of Ross and Monica Geller can't be mutants, how will they be integrated in the Avengers universe and the Ultron storyline be without stepping on 20th Century Fox's toes? I'm not sure, but the dialogue, I'm sure, will be Pulitzer Prize worthy. And finally, in what can be described as an absolute travesty, the Roadhouse remake has gotten a green light.
Whoa.
I'm pretty sure that Patrick Swayze, who is getting baby out of the corner up in heaven, went to God or Morgan Freeman, depending on your beliefs, and screamed, "Can't you do something about this? Look what they did to Red Dawn!" Apparently not, because Rob Cohen, who directed the first Fast and Furious movie, and XXX will helm the remake, which we can only imagine means Vin Diesel is playing a distant cousin of Dalton? Plot lines haven't been revealed, but I'm guessing a throat rip is mandatory and a blind guitarist's blind son will play integral roles in the writing process. I can only say that when the numbers from the opening weekend roll in, some MGM exec will most certainly be forced to echo, "I thought they'd be bigger." I'm Josh McCougan, and those are your Schmoes No headlines, sponsored by Magic Hat Brewing and SchmoesNo.com.
Yeah.
So, Macuga, how'd you feel about it?
Not that good.
To borrow a quote from Footloose. Whoa. Let's settle down. To borrow a quote from Roadhouse, pain don't hurt, and neither did hearing you do the news.
Yeah, that's thanks, nice. Guys. Yeah.
Thank you. Well done. I mean, you got the pit boss breathing down your neck like Smaug.
Yeah.
Smaug.
You know, that was good.
Ken, you got any notes?
I thought it was a valid attempt on some of the humor. That's hard to get the rhythm down. Hard to get the rhythm down, but you did good, and you were, above all, informative. I make half the news up. You had a lot of facts.
Very nice.
Thanks, Ken. Thank you so much.
Stand behind me and tweet something real quick.
Yeah.
There you go.
I'd like to know what Erin Darling thought.
I liked it, and I like the suit, too. You look great. And also, for the record, I think I chose him on my celebrity impression dating.
No, you did not.
No, you took me. No, you took me. Arnold. You took Arnold.
And that's what I did.
That's only because she interviewed Arnold for real life.
That's right. I had a DNP that time. Yeah.
Let's talk about some of this news that the Wild Man reported on. Now, the first would be, let's just get right into this stupid Roadhouse thing. It's like,
the other
thing you forgot that they need to include is the Die Hard score repetitive. Remember, in the original, they just continuously played, Lethal Weapon and Die Hard, they continuously just played the same saxophones throughout the entire movie.
Yeah, yeah. Back when that rock and saxophone meant something.
Why in God's name would they make this? And here's the reason why. Like, even with It's a Wonderful Life last week when we talked about it, how they're going to do a sequel, which is terrible. But... I'm against that idea of them making a sequel to that. However, that makes more sense than this, and this is why, because It's a Wonderful Life. You can the overall story can be translated. You don't have to really be a fan of it. You can get it and understand. Like you'll get those the morals and what they're trying to say and the message of the film. Roadhouse is for a specific audience.
Yep.
Roadhouse is for in the 80s, like when you knew like that is for an audience. And like what like people don't care. Like if you never saw the original Roadhouse, you're not going to give a shit that movie was
remade. Are you kidding me? Wait. Did you hear who the director is? They're going to do what to this like they did with the Fast and the Furious franchise. It is a specific audience, and it's maybe not as wide of an audience as It's a Wonderful Life, but you just keep going into bars.
But why remake the movie? That's my point though. Why remake that film?
Because there is a brand recognizability with Roadhouse. Am I wrong?
No, yes. you're wrong. That's my point.
We had a fight about Christian. I got in a deep fight about this before we did. We were doing one of our top five movies.com lists, mm-hmm. and I really wanted. I can't remember what it was. It was like most recognizable restaurants or something. And I said, you got to put the Double Deuce in there.
Yeah.
And Christian, nobody knows what the Double Deuce
nobody
is.
Nobody knows.
Like, everybody knows what the Double Deuce is.
You know what? Here's the thing. If you are under 22 years old, call into the show right now. 323-622-8623. And first question is, do you know what the hell the Double Deuce is? Second is, do you give a shit about Roadhouse?
I guarantee you my last punch sign when I thought they'd be bigger, half our audience didn't get it.
That's what I'm
saying.
That's
the thing. Roadhouse collapsed in the theater. Like, it didn't do well.
No,
but it got the cult following.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Right? And it's that, again, it's the same thing as Red Dawn. It's the same thing as most of these 80s movies. Is the reason that they survive is because they were 80s awesome. Like, you redo Commando now, it's not going to work. But Commando worked back then because it was the shit.
Yeah, Arnold Schwarzenegger took down the whole island. And he's the biggest star on the planet.
No, but I think that if you remade Commando right now, it wouldn't do as well. But if you actually took it and you modernized it, then that's a story you can tell again. I see where
Macuga's coming from is that there's a certain thing back then.
Right.
But with the era of the 80s and that certain, there was a different type of action star back then. Now you're right, Ellis. It is all about the Fast and Furious type action
star. That's what they're going to do.
But it depends on who they get. But let's go to the lines. Hey, you're in Schmoville. Who do we got?
This is Awkward Kid Blake back now at the turn of the tide.
Nice. Blake, so how old are you, my friend?
I am 17.
Okay. Now,
you sound 45.
Have you ever seen Roadhouse?
Hell yeah.
Okay, wait a minute. That's fine. Now, would you know straight off the bat, and be honest, what the Double Deuce was if I just asked you, hey, what's the Double Deuce? Would you have to think about it for a second, or would you know right away that's from Roadhouse?
I'd have to think about it for a second, but
then he'd get it. I mean, you need a synapse to explode in your head before you know it, but it'll happen.
But
ask him if he knew. Did you watch the first Red Dawn before you saw the second Red
ask
Dawn?
Ask him if you're on the phone with him.
Did you see the first Red Dawn before you saw the second Red Dawn? Do you even know the first Red Dawn? Leah Thompson, Patrick Swayze.
Yeah, I'm a big Patrick Swayze fan. I love.
Okay, so Blake's obviously a big movie fan though too.
Sure.
So and
oh, majority, okay, so that's cheating.
What I'm saying is though, the majority of the audiences are not going to know Roadhouse.
Then let's do a bet right now because I think when Roadhouse comes out, the remake or whatever, I think it's going to do well at the box office. I think that nostalgia is going to come back.
It depends on the cast.
It depends on the cast, and it really depends on the trailer and how it comes out, too. Look, you know me. I'm the first person that if I'm proven wrong, I'll go, shit, I was wrong about that.
You're not the first person. You're the seventh person.
The other day, we were walking out of something, and I said, I can't remember what it was, but I was like, and I said, you know, I don't know, it was Finnick. It was for Hunger Games. I said, I thought he was going to be terrible, and he was fantastic in the role.
Yeah. I do not recall that conversation, Senator. But, yeah, no, you'll own up to it, but I'm just saying, I think that there is an audience for Roadhouse out there.
Thanks
Erin,
for the call,
your
Blake.
Thoughts.
I just don't want to see this happen for a couple of reasons. One, I love the 80s. I respect 1989. I respect tight jeans.
Right.
And how are you going to recreate some of the best, worst dialogue
ever made? Ever. That's, again, it just goes back to the charm.
Yep. It's part of the nostalgia.
The guy drove around in a giant Bigfoot truck. Yeah. That was part of the je ne sais quoi
movie. Yeah, and it was right around the Swayze era when Swayze had that thing. And, too, it depends on who they get.
I'm just saying you can take elements of that and put it into a modern time. It's not that hard.
I'd like to see you create it, Mike.
I'll rip your throat out.
Erin, you know, I have a small bone to pick with you.
Okay.
Because I saw Mark Reilly's episode of It's a Wrap that he was on. And I don't know if it's a bone to pick, but I guess I disagree.
Christian wanted to be on it.
I disagree with you in the fact that I thought the X-Men Days of Future Past trailer is incredible. I love the dark and dreary tone of it.
Oh, did Erin Darling not like it?
I was a little bit bored of it. I thought the pacing was really, really slow. There's a lot of, you know, single shot moments. So here's this character, but no context into what the hell is going on.
Okay.
And with
can I hear the woman's point?
That was my problem with it. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, with this confusing timeline, with all the time bending stuff going back and forth and all the different characters, I think it's just more of we're going to get people excited to see this character and this character and this character, but anyone that was at Comic-Con or anyone since then is already excited for that. We already know what's coming. So give us a little bit more.
Let me bring an uneasy piece to this.
I have to respond to that.
Okay. But I like talking too.
Here's the first thing. Is that you said your point as far as Comic-Con goes. Not everybody goes to Comic-Con. There's a selected few people that go to Comic-Con.
But considering it was months ago, a lot of people know what happened.
No, because it was not released on the internet. That was the thing. So it was? No, it was not.
The panel was.
I know, because I was working for an outlet that did release
it. The panel was, but the trailer was not.
That's true.
And that's the thing. So, and the other thing was in regards to what they showed and getting you excited, That's the goal of the very first trailer, is the teaser to get you. The second trailer is usually the one that gives you the juice of the story. I thought the trailer did its job, got you amped up and ready to go for the X-Men franchise.
I was not privileged enough, like you nerds, to be at that Comic-Con panel where they actually showed the trailer footage, so I had never seen it before. Now, I knew that the character was going to be in there because I'm in the business. But again, I got to side with Christian on here for this reason, because a lot of people, maybe they know there's another X-Men movie, but they're still asking their friends, they're like, hey, wait, is this guy going to be in it? Is this guy going to be in it? And I think that that's more important from a sales standpoint, to get asses in the seats, to get people to want to buy popcorn, as opposed to, hey, dude, a lot of these X-Men are going to meet this X-Men, and then maybe JFK didn't get shot, and then all this other shit went down, as opposed to just showing, hey, I remember that dude. He's going to be hanging out with that dude. That's really cool. So I, as much as I hate doing it, I got to go with Christian on this one.
Yeah, and the other thing is I just think that the music in Comic-Con, they used Time from Hans. I do agree the music was jarring, but that was because they couldn't get the rights from Warner Brothers to use the Hans Zimmer piece, and I thought that's what made that piece really work at Comic-Con. All right, I'm going to take one more call from Schmoville.
I like
here.
The guy with the claws. Yeah. They're metal. Metallicum.
Yeah. Hey, you're in Schmoville. Who do we got?
Good evening, Christian. Schmoville. This is Thomas Hughes, Winter Park, Florida, USA.
What's up?
These guys are right on
it. They're right on it, man. Thomas, what's up, brother? What do you got for us?
Not much, Christian. Hated your last live show for a while, but first things first, I am 21 years old, had no idea what the double deuce was until you guys mentioned it. But
see?
Well, you're 21
dude,
now, so now you
can get don't worry about
in.
It, dude. Let's get into it. Watch Roadhouse and enjoy it for all of the insanity that is an 80s action movie. wait till the end. I don't want to ruin the end for you, but you're going to love every second of this movie.
I'll ruin this. Patrick Swayze lives in a loft with no
Dunkin'
cable
Donuts.
TV.
Right.
I'll look into it. Since it's the last show for a while, I wanted to say I don't know if you guys watched the
Drama Queen
50th anniversary. I'm sorry.
No, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Okay, I was gonna say I don't know if I just want to say if you guys this weekend or anybody in Schmoville saw the 50th anniversary of Doctor Who. It was an incredible show. Blew me away.
Yeah, you know,
just wanted to throw that out there.
Actually, if you go to schmoesno.com, our new writer Patrick Gorman actually just wrote a whole article on the Doctor Who special that was on. It's a great read, so you should check that out.
I know Mark Aquino saw it. That's all I know.
Time Lord.
Thank you very much. All right, Mark, we're about to go to break here, and then we're going to have Craig Brewer. But do you want to talk about this Aaron Taylor Johnson thing on the X-Men? Well, not X-Men, Avengers. And how do you feel about it?
Why are you setting me up like this?
No, I'm curious. Like, how do you feel? You like Kick-Ass. That's why I asked you.
Yeah, I think he's a great. But you introduced it like that's how my grandfather would say, Mike, you want to tell a joke before Thanksgiving dinner starts? Mark has something funny to say.
I don't get to talk. So I wanted to give you the chance.
Yeah, but you gave me a shit story. I don't care. Aaron Taylor Johnson.
What a little girl you're being. Give me the good story. How do you feel about Star Wars, Precious?
What are you talking about?
Which one do you want?
Man, this Drama Queen really set you guys apart.
Really did.
It's really driving a wedge in between the power couple over here.
Yeah. Which one?
I'm going to go have a beer at the Double Deuce and kick some ass.
All right,
I thought you'd be a lot bigger.
Yeah, I think it's cool. Aaron Taylor Johnson is going to be in the new Avengers.
Yeah.
All right. Bring it on.
It's been confirmed the last couple of days or two, but I like the idea.
The kid knows how to work out, dude.
Yeah.
He does.
Yeah.
Oh,
I'm a fan. I love him.
You a big fan? All right. Yeah. Well, guys, we're here with Erin Darling, Mark Ellis, Christian Harloff, Schmoes, No Movies. When we get back, we'll be joined by the director, Craig Brewer. Very excited to talk about his movie, The Poor and the Hungry.
Yeah.
You're listening to the Toad Hop Network, radio worth watching.
What's up, Toadheads? Hey, make sure you check out the Toad Hop store on ToadHopNetwork.com. It's a great way to support the network and helps continue to bring you quality programming.
Quality programming, my ass.
Can you see I'm recording you?
So maybe you've got a great idea for a business and want to start selling your products or services online. Maybe you're an established business owner looking for new customers. Or maybe you're interested in starting a personal website. No matter who you are, GoDaddy wants to help you kick ass online. Right now, GoDaddy's offering .com domains for just $1.99. It's go time. Start your website today. Visit GoDaddy.com and enter promo code TOAD to get your $1.99.com or click on the GoDaddy graphic on the Toad Hop website. Some limitations apply. See website for details.
To leave your house to shop, to crawl through traffic to the mall.
Just to find the thing you wanted.
Isn't even there at all.
Amazon.com is the answer.
Shop at home in style and ease.
Find exactly what you want.
Ordering your stuff's a breeze.
Books on tape.
Games galore.
Everything you're looking for.
Kindle. Cameras. Electronics.
Baby Einstein.
Hooked on phonics.
Blu-ray.
Movies.
And TV.
Download.
Music.
MP3.
Pixar.
Disney.
Microphones.
Pet supplies and doggy bones.
World of Warcraft.
Nancy Drew.
Sims.
The Scruff System too.
Click Amazon.
You'll smile with glee.
Sometimes shipping's even free.
What's up, everyone? Sports Guru here. Sick of looking at the same old boring websites? Well, check out the new sportsguru.com for all the hottest trending videos and all the biggest sports news. Become a VIP for only $4.99 and get premium access to everything the Sports Guru has to offer. The beautiful gurus, girls, all my biggest sports picks, and much more. So get off that porn site and check out the new sportsguru.com.
Is that hunk of junk you call a car always breaking down and leaving you in the dust? Log on to Dyson-Motors.com and check out Dyson's full inventory online. With hundreds of quality cars in stock of all makes and models, you can find the next car of your dreams in minutes. And know you're getting super low pricing. Purchase a car today from Dyson Motors and receive a year of free oil changes. Bad credit? Worried about financing? Log on and get pre-approved in seconds. Go to Dyson-Motors.com and find your new car today.
With Gamefly, choose from over 6,000 titles. Play as long as you want and send them back when you're done. $8.95 to start. No late fees. Gamefly.com. Games delivered.
You're listening to the Toad Hop Network. Radio worth watching.
That sounds familiar.
It does indeed.
You know it's hard out here for a pimp.
God, it is hard for a pimp. And it is hard for Mark Ellis. Welcome back to the Schmoes No Movies podcast. I'm the little girl, Mark. Over there is Christian.
The one who never lets anyone talk.
Erin Darling, sitting in for Tiffany Smith, doing a fantastic job. The whole Schmoes crew is here on a very special Monday night episode. And that's the only reason why I'm not wearing one of our favorite sponsors, Ripped Apparel t-shirt, is because the Redskins are currently embarrassing our nation as a whole on Monday night football. So I figured I would wear my Robert Griffin III shirt. But make sure you check out RippedApparel.com.
Yeah.
And if you go there right now and you tell them you're from Schmoville by entering in our code, it is SK Dark World. For the rest of November, you get $1 off the already incredible price of what is that? $10.
Yeah, and they have a lot of great stuff too. They have sweatshirts, they have headphones now, they have posters, they have a lot of great, great stuff. But Ripped, I love you to death. Too excited right now for our guest to talk about you anymore. I gotta talk about our guest in studio, live in studio. He's been on the phone with us once before.
That's right.
Now we have the director of one of my favorite movies. You just heard Hustle and Flow, and that would be Craig Brewer. Welcome to Schmoville,
yes,
my
sir.
Friend.
How's it going?
Yeah.
How are you?
Thank you.
Yeah. Well, it's very nice to have you finally. You've been and this is to let Schmoville out there know the power of Twitter. And we talked about this last time you're on the phone. You found us through Twitter.
Yeah. Yeah. And then I started watching the video, the reviews and everything. And then I found a lot of friends that also knew about you guys.
Oh, that's
so
awesome.
So it was this cool thing where I kind of discovered you guys first on Twitter, and then I found a whole community that already knew about you.
Yeah, it was. I remember that when we found out that Craig Brewer retweeted our review of Footloose. The first thing I thought, you, because you called me, you're like, "Hey, the director of Footloose retweeted our review," and I'm like, "Shit, did I like it? What did I say about it?"
No, it was actually one of my favorite reviews of Footloose, and it wasn't like if you took a text of it or something like that. That's not what I meant. But like watching you guys come to terms with that, you know, there was a lot that you liked about with it, you know, and there was also a part of you that was almost apologetic about it. Like I knew what that was like, and I recognized it. So
you were working, you were going up, pushing a boulder for that one, because it's like that going back to what we were talking about with Roadhouse. I don't know if you heard.
I heard.
Oh yeah,
and remaking Roadhouse. Now you know what the double deuce is, right?
In Roadhouse.
Yeah. Yeah. See? Right. Brewer gets
on my, I was telling earlier, I do a tech scout with all my movies, where you pile into a bus and you go with your crew to every location, and there's always these these DVD players, and you can play movies on the way to locations, and I always get to choose the movie.
Oh, cool!
So it usually is Purple Rain and Roadhouse.
Nice,
great guest.
Yeah, Purple Rain it's always great, but Roadhouse gets some groans at first, but then like people start.
Yeah,
they get involved.
I'll tell you what, man, those dogs ain't crying when Roadhouse.
No, not when throats are getting ripped out. And then
I wonder if they'll be as violent as the original.
That's the
Roadhouse.
Thing is, I just don't know if they can recapture. But again, it's a great point.
It's a rare thing to see a good remake.
But now, when Footloose was announced, before I knew you were directing, I was like, why? Why are they doing it? I mean, to be honest. And
I said it too.
And that was the thing. So, and then when I saw, and I knew you were directing too, and I was a really big fan of Hustle and Flow, so I was like, okay. And we both said he did it. He made a successful remake, and that was the thing. It can be done, but that's like Makuga said before. It's casting, it's absolutely directing, and it's tone, and it's being faithful to the original.
Yeah, it's this fine line because you want to be faithful. You can't do like a complete. You can't do something where people are like, well, why did they even call it Roadhouse or Footloose?
Right.
Why didn't they just call it something else? Because it was so completely different than the original. So you got to be really careful about that. But I think what I struggled with, I remember being on the phone with the head of the studio going like, no, I can't do it because I just can't get behind this banning dancing thing.
Right.
Like because in the original, it was all about saving your soul. Like
right.
They didn't want mm-hmm. you to burn in hell if you dance.
Right.
And I just didn't see that culture really, even in the South, like even the most strict religions there, I mean, they're still going to let you boogie,
even
for Jesus, what I mean?
Right.
So,
well, you kids are dancing for the Lord, I'll let it go.
But I think what I had to do was like, see, when I was 13, I was really into Kevin Bacon. I thought, yeah. I mean, when I saw him in Footloose, I was like, that's who I want to be. I want to be that cool,
I want to dance in a barn one day.
Yeah, yeah, I want to be that mad.
He made me want to be a bike messenger after I saw
that
Quicksilver.
Fast.
Yeah. Oh my God.
But I had to find out that really I'm not Kevin Bacon anymore. I'm a, kind of a potbelly dad too. and so I understand fear. And
right.
I understand like if your kids are, if there's like some tragedy where like four kids were killed and somebody came to me and said, actually, we need to protect your kids from having the same thing happening. I'd definitely listen. If
yeah.
there was something I had to sign, I would read it.
Right.
I wouldn't be like, no, I don't want to infringe on any, anybody's freedoms or anything.
Right.
I'd think about it because you just get paralyzed with fear once you have kids.
And that's what I also loved about your version, too, is I always, when I saw the original, I was like, I wonder what happened there. Like, I wish they would have shown that. And in the beginning of the movie, you showed that. So
I'm very curious as to the Roadhouse thing. Like, what's going to flip that? I mean, is it just like you just get somebody else that could be Patrick? What have you guys been thinking? I mean, first of all, what's the gauge here? I haven't been hearing. Like, what do you guys think? Is this a good idea, bad idea?
I think that there's an audience for it. And I think that people would be excited to see where they take Roadhouse. And again, like I said before, I'm not saying you have to have the jeans that tight and the mullets that big, but you can make this story.
Then what's the point?
Right.
Come on.
You're going to have those jokes, though. Those jokes are definitely going to be in there.
Yeah.
I wouldn't be surprised to see Sam Elliott
walking
around.
I love Sam Elliott showed back
see?
Up.
See? There you now I'm
that
winning
would
you over.
Be cool.
Like I said,
that would be cool.
I love Roadhouse.
We'll put Kevin Bacon in it so Brewer goes to see it.
But, it all depends on how it's done, man. It really depends on how it's done. And I didn't like what they did with Red Dawn at all.
Well, I'll tell you this. I hope that and Rob Cohen, he's made some cool movies too. But in order to get a remake like that at all, you have to have some talent. You need a talented director, which is what they got for the Footloose remake. And I want to talk to you about how you started down the path of directing with this film that is just getting a re-release now, The Poor and Hungry.
Right.
And
you,
because that was the thing. Talking about Twitter, Craig had reached out to us too, and he let us know. You are distributing this yourself, am I?
Yeah, and it's really specific. Like, I'm doing it all myself.
Yeah.
I had an opportunity where I could hire somebody to like help me with it, and I was like, I wonder if I can just do it with people and reach out personally to people and to bloggers and news organizations and that's all I'm doing.
You use social media for it. But so why, let me ask you a question though. So this was the one that got you started, but so why now are you deciding to distribute? I'm just curious.
Well, a couple of things. Yeah. One is Footloose, paid me some money.
Yeah.
I hadn't had any of that in
right.
a while. So it was nice because I always felt like this was the movie that I felt was my best.
Yeah.
I mean, and now I know that some people may look at it and they may look at my other movies and they may say, well, there's other movies that are the best. But Have you all ever worked on something where you were like, I gave my absolute all to this? Now it may
not in a while. Not in a while, Craig. Been a long time. Right.
Yeah. That's what this was. It was like there will never be another situation where I would have given so much and it meant so much to me. I mean, like it was at a time in my life where I felt like I was in the middle of nowhere. I wasn't even in Memphis, Tennessee. I was in this town outside of Memphis, Tennessee called Collierville, Tennessee.
Okay.
And I wanted so desperately to make a movie. And I think that, you know, it was this phone conversation that I had with my father because he was in San Francisco and working there, and he had read the script of The Poor and Hungry and was like, this is good. It's about car thieves and this underbelly of Memphis. But I had tried to make a movie before on film and it really like just tore me up because I spent too much money on it and it just went nowhere. But he was telling me like, don't be afraid, like pick up one of these video cameras, go out there and don't apologize for not having any money. It'd be different if you were doing something that was supposed to have a lot of money, but your movie's called The Poor and Hungry.
Yeah.
So just go ahead and shoot it. And it was the last conversation we had. He died unexpectedly.
Wow.
I got a call later that day that he was complaining of back pains. And so like, and now I'm a dad. And right. So I look at like how he checked out and yeah. I want to like high five him. It was like, it was a perfect, I mean, if I wrote it in a script, yeah. I mean, he
that's,
was like.
And that's kind of shaped your life now, huh?
Completely. And I mean, it really did because I went out every day with that video camera. Wow. It was like me and my brother-in-law and we were just trying to make that great American movie.
Yeah.
And I really do think that I at least made one. And John Singleton then saw it.
Right.
And
that's Stephanie what I was gonna
Elaine,
ask, yeah.
who produced Hustle and Flow. And that's really what got me the gig.
Yeah.
Like not so much the script was, I think was good, but there was too many people telling me that they wanted somebody else to direct it. But it was that movie, The Poor and Hungry, where everybody was like, no, just give him a budget and he can do it.
Yeah, we've had a chance to check out the movie and it really is fantastic. It's so fun to watch. And I think what I was wondering, first of all, is it's everything is in Memphis. It actually was shot in Memphis.
Yeah.
And it takes place there.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of Memphis strip clubs. So was this movie just an excuse to go to Memphis strip clubs?
Oh, yeah. As a matter of fact, I'll give you a couple of strip club stories. One is, of course, if you watch Hustle.
Uh-huh. Yeah,
so there's this moment where you go, it's raining outside the strip club, and you go inside and there's buckets on the stage with water because it's raining and the rain is coming through the stage. And so the first time that I was doing Poor and Hungry, I went to that club. It's called King of Clubs on Brooks Avenue.
Oh, yeah.
And it was just pouring rain and they had buckets on the stage and the dancers were moving on. So when I went in with Hustle and Flow, I had very few times on Hustle where I could feel like I was an authority, like I'd never worked with a crew before. I'd never, you know, John really helped me with like managing that size of a crew because otherwise I did everything. I lit everything. I shot everything myself.
Poor and Hungry.
I edited it myself. Wow. Everything. But this one day, like we walk into the strip club and I'd film there. Like I got my career started in this strip club. Like strippers that, you know, held the boom pole for me in my first
literally.
Movie.
Strippers that wouldn't now, talk to you back with Poor and Hungry. Now they're now they're like, Mr. Brewer, can I get a part?
I'll never forget her. Her name was Tequila and she held that microphone for me when we didn't have enough crew in heels. God bless her soul.
Oh my God.
Is that
so,
a real name?
She's a doctor
it's,
now.
It's not a real name.
A good story.
Actually,
yeah.
She's a nurse.
Is she?
It's really funny you say that.
They went through medical school.
Wow.
But I was in there and I was like, okay, I need dancers over here. I need dancers over there. I need three buckets on the stage. And they're like, whoa, wait a minute. What's all this bucket stuff? And I was like, where's effects? And they're like, there's effects in this stream. And I was like, yeah, I need water to pour down here. And people didn't know what I was talking about. Right. But then you saw it all put together and they were like, oh, I get it. It's like raining.
So, I mean, going back to with Poor and Hungry, though, too, something that I like watching, and this is something I said to Mark before, too. When you watch these, especially the smaller films, and especially the ones in black and white too, and you know right away when you're watching them, you have the independent feel, and there's a specific type of a feel to them. What I would say too, like again with the Clerks, one of my favorites of all time, and that, but even a movie like Clerks, some of the acting, it's like because you're getting your friends and stuff too. Dude, the acting in this movie is really fucking good. What happened to some of these people? Like, what happened to Lindsay Roberts? What happened to her? She's so good.
She's really good.
Yeah.
She's still in Memphis. She does theater. As a matter of fact, my daughter came home the other day and said, Daddy, I saw Peter Pan. And I was like, oh, I know Peter Pan. And then she's this you know, cute yeah. girl that now's a mother. Wow. But she's started doing a lot of features in Memphis as well. But she's a great actress.
Does she want to do anything else too? Or
of course, you mean like be famous? Yeah, and all but that I mean
like
stuff,
the, yeah, like do the like the bigger roles and stuff.
Oh
too?
Sure,
yeah,
okay. Oh sure. It's just you know you got to remember like Poor and Hungry was such a well much like Hustle and Flow except that it kind of went on to you know be this almost classic movie. But yeah. they were very regional films. They were very regionally minded. Like right. I really felt that Poor and Hungry was made for Memphis. And to some extent, Hustle and Flow was kind of just made for Memphis. And I'm happy that the world is looking on with it. But there's lines in there that confuse everybody. Like there's this one line in Hustle and Flow that people always get confused where DJ, he's being arrested and he's being put in the car and he tells Nola, he goes, hey, I want to hear my shit playing in the yard at 201. And everybody's like, what radio station is that? And I was like, no, 201 is the address of the prison in Memphis, Tennessee. Now, people in Memphis know that.
Yeah.
So playing in the yard at 201, like there's all these kind of things where people in Memphis goes, oh, my God, I know what that is.
Right.
But nobody else does. And so I think that even with the cast, like I partied just last night with the lead, Eric Tate,
yeah.
you know, at this great video store in Memphis called Black Lodge Video.
What's he up to now?
He's directing films, okay. and I'm gonna you know help produce one of his films.
Cool.
So we're all kind of growing up and trying to like do other things. But I will say John Still,
yeah.
who is the old man
oh, right,
who
right.
plays the chop
Mr.
shop
Coles.
Owner. Now he's mm-hmm. been in all of my films. He was in Hustle and Flow. He played the guy at the pawn shop who's selling the microphone to DJ.
Oh, right, yeah.
He's also in Black Snake Moan. He gives Justin Timberlake a hard time
okay.
when he comes back from getting a dishonorable discharge.
Right.
And I just for luck, I put him in Footloose when Julianne Hough goes crazy and she goes onto the track in the dirt track in Footloose and she gets in the car. Some old man's yelling like, "Get that girl off the track!"
Oh,
so that's John.
Oh,
so he's my little good luck charm.
Yeah,
he's suffering with some cancer right now and trying
oh,
to get
man.
Through it. So I'm trying to write another movie so I can put it in him just to get his spirits.
Yeah.
Out.
Well, how do you again with. Because a lot of times people just put their friends in, and were they all your friends, and you got lucky with that they were actually really good, or did you know them? Did you audition them? Like how did you get them?
We rehearsed a whole lot.
Okay,
and I come from theater. I grew up in the theater, and I just I knew that one of the tricky things with films is when you have an argument with two people.
Yeah,
and the reason why it's tricky is that you can't just always run two cameras on somebody. You kind of have to run camera on one person, you stop, you move the room around, you move all the lights around, and you film the other person, which makes interrupting each other very difficult
yeah.
to do because you never quite do it on the same spot every time, and you never get that spontaneity of like, man, this conversation's happening.
That's why we have two cameras in here when Christian and I get in a fight.
Right.
We got to both roll.
It helps.
Yeah, it was a good one before.
So we would do these rehearsals where we would just run two cameras at the same time. And it really made it seem natural. And so I worked at Barnes & Noble. I shelved books, and I saw that guy, Eric Tate. He was browsing in films. He was looking at a book up on Hitchcock. And I was like, man, you kind of look like a bouncer. Would you maybe be in this movie that I'm doing? And I really just walked up to him. I had my name tag on and everything.
Oh, wow.
And that's how I got that lead actor.
It really is one of those stories. Yeah.
So that was kind of lucky, though, too, because what if he wasn't good? You know, because he, dude, I'm telling you, these, like, they are, that performance by, Elizabeth?
Lindsay Roberts.
Lindsay Roberts. When she shows up, and again, you're going, okay, let's see what the performance is like. It's the first thing you're looking at when you're like, when it goes back and forth because of what the story's about. And I was like, where is she? Like,
yeah.
why am I watching her on TV right now? But going into the story though, Craig, like, why did you pick the chop shop? Like, what was it about? Like, did you know people in that area? Like, what happened? Like, that you decided you wanted to make?
You have a history with stealing cars.
Yeah,
what we're
yeah,
asking
yeah. Did you
you
break down some cars?
No,
or?
What it was is my sister-in-law. Her name's Erin, and she
good name. Good name for a woman sitting right next to you. There you go.
She's been great. She's also not only been my assistant, but she's produced some things that I've done and everything. So that first film that we were doing that went absolutely nowhere. Her big Chevy Caprice classic was our grip car. And she, on one night, we decided to take all our equipment out of it, and she decided to go into the city to see this boy that she was kind of sweet on.
Mm-hmm.
So she comes out of the apartment, of this guy's house, and her car has been stolen. And so 3 days later, we get a call from the police department saying that they found her car and just go down to the impound and get it. So we thought there'd be like a broken windshield or something like that. But we go down to the police impound, and they drive us out to the car, and it's up on these bricks. And the wheel wells, the tires, the doors, the hood, the steering column, the engine. I've never, it's just this skeleton, just the shell.
And have no buddy of mine, because they won't tell you. When they find your car, they won't tell you what condition it's in. They're like, hey, we found your car. And he's like, they found my car. And I'm like, well, is it okay? And he's like, they won't tell me. So you go down there and you just see this shell. And then you see your friend break down. You just want to laugh at him.
Yeah, and they say, I mean, they even say, come down here and get it.
Yeah.
Like, you drive it away.
Right.
You know, it's like, so I'm sitting there while my, while Erin is crying over this car that she hated, and she, and I remember her saying things like, you know, don't they, I mean, how am I going to get to work? Don't these people who stole my car realize that I have to? I don't have any money that I got to get to work, and so I'm hanging back with one of the cops, and I'm saying like, well, what do I do? I can't. We can't just put this in the trunk of our car that we drove up in. What do we do with this? And he goes, look, you can either pay us $90 service fee and take it with you. Or leave it here, and on Wednesday, we have an auction, and people come and buy it. And I was like, oh. And they go, yeah, but we got to check their license, because sometimes the people who stole the car chop the car down, keep all the parts, dump the shell, come to the auction, get the pinks for $90, and then put your car back together. And now they legally own your car to sell out of town.
When that was described in the movie, I was like, that shit happened. Like, I didn't know it happened, but when you said that, I was like, that shit happens.
I didn't know it happened either.
But just from the way that your character describes it in the movie, I knew, I had never heard it, but I knew from the way he described it, that happens.
All the time in the South, my old stomping grounds, absolutely, Craig, I want to ask you about just watching the film as a whole. It's one of those things where it is an indie film through and through, and but it's so confident in the storytelling and the acting and the way you pulled it off. So my question is, was there ever a time when you're making it when you weren't that confident in what the final product was going to be? I mean, you went through this tragedy, you lost your old man, you're making this movie, and he really loved the script, and you have that memory in your head of that film that you were making that just you just couldn't finish it. So was there ever like a breaking point here, and how did you get through it to see the film to completion?
Oh, sure. Oh, yeah. I mean, it was just, I mean, so many times I lost hope. And I mean, if you, it's funny because if you watch Hustle and Flow, but you knew us, so many people were like, oh my God, Hustle and Flow is you guys making Poor and Hungry.
Really?
Oh, it really was.
Yeah.
I mean, and I'm not saying like I'm a pimp or anything like that, but
you
I was
kind of are.
But I was the pimp.
The beard, the jacket, it's rock and roll, Craig.
Well, what it was is that, you know, my if you see DJ in the movie, he's driving a Chevy Caprice Classic. That was the car that was stolen.
Right.
Right. Mm-hmm. And it's also a really big Memphis car. They've all got the, you know, everybody in Memphis likes these boxcar Chevys and everything. And so there was me. There was my sister-in-law, Erin, who was later my assistant. She was kind of shy, but she would sit in the car with me. We'd sweat our asses off waiting for a location to be available. I'd go into a gas station and say, hey, man, you have a cool look. You know, would you want to be in a movie? And they'd be like, yeah. And I was like, okay, but can we use your gas station too? So I would kind of lie, you know, and then I just wouldn't use that footage of him. I was kind of like being kind of a, you know, I was a hustler, really.
Yeah.
And then my brother-in-law, he was the more quiet, technical one. He held the boom pole. He held the lights. He lit everything. And then there was my wife. And she got pregnant, so she got bigger and bigger, just like Taraji Henson and Footloose. And she kind of kept her. Whenever we were down, she would come in and with the lava lamp in the scene and just, like, raise our spirits. And so there's so many times that I remember one time where I just really thought I had spent like a year and a half to 2 years just making something that didn't work. And I remember just my wife coming in and sitting on my lap and watching it. And she's going, I think it's beautiful. And it was just, I just needed it. And there's, I don't know if you guys have done this where you've been working on something, it's just you. And then suddenly somebody comes in who hasn't been a part of it and they just really love it. And it just is almost like all of your doubts just completely evaparate.
Every single person, in this room.
Pick up Mark Ellis, Get to the Castle, available on CD.
No, it's great, too, because Mark and I, it was just the two of us in front of the webcam. And now, you know, like we're surrounded by talented people right now that make this brand better every day.
Yeah,
so I totally
hangers on, talented people. Yeah, there's a lot of people in the studio.
Makuga's working his ass off right now.
Yeah. Is he dancing?
No, he's texting. So but again, the movie is I know you are. The movie is porn hungry, and we are here with director Craig Brewer. The Schmoville is asking, where can they find this movie if they want to purchase it?
Well, this is what's cool, is that you just go to thepoorandhungry.com.
Okay. Poorandhungry.com.
Thepoorandhungry.com. Yeah, that domain name was still available.
I got it back in the day, like back when, like, and I just kept on keeping it all this time. But yeah, the you can go on to thepoorandhungry.com, and this is just me selling it, meaning like it's if you don't want to buy it, I want to give it away for free. So there's a free download if you want to just play the movie on your phone or on your iPad or tablet or anything. It's free. You just put your email in, and I send you a link to it. It's not streaming. You would own it. But I've got a lot of cool stuff in there. You know, I got like signed posters and Blu-rays. I got this. Oh, I'm wearing it right now. I got the T-shirt, which is the old mural that used to be on the side of the P&H Cafe where I filmed everything. And so we got like screen art prints and everything. So it's like it's fun, and it's the first time I'm actually like really self-distributing anything. And I want it to be the first film that I self-distribute, because it was my first film and I want to do it again. Like I want to do a big ass Hollywood movie, but I'd also like to do like another $20,000 movie that I'm holding the camera in my hands myself.
That was my next question again, because even like look at something like Joss Whedon just did, you know, obviously the Avengers is huge, and then he goes back and directs
Much Ado About Nothing.
Yeah. And that was kind of a passion thing for him too. And granted, it wasn't $2,000-$3,000 movie, but it was. But still, it was a much smaller scale than what he was.
It was black and white.
Exactly what Craig had just kind of said there, too. So my next question is, what's next, like, in the big scale things? Because you are a super talented director, and there are guys out there that are not that great, and they're getting these huge, big movies and working on stuff. And sometimes I'm like, how is this guy still directing movies? And then it's... Why haven't I seen you doing more big stuff? Is that a personal choice? Is it because sometimes clashing with the studios? What's the story?
It's a little bit of both. I mean, I think that it's interesting because I just read that book Linda Opes did called Sleepless in Hollywood, where it talks about how the whole industry kind of changed from 2007 on. Mm-hmm. Now, 2007 is when Black Snake Moan came out. I'm not saying that Black Snake Moan did this or changed the industry or anything, but it was definitely at this time where the global marketplace just got really, really big, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. and movies had to be of a certain, you know, accessibility to a global audience. And the two things that I kept on being told that foreign audiences did not like was anything African-American or anything Southern. And I was like, really? Because I usually do movies about Southern African Americans, and that's like I wanted to do a Charlie Pride movie, and all. And what it is, and this is what I've been told. I don't know if it's bullshit or not, but they say that people in Europe or you know, in Japan don't have the African American experience. Like they don't even have what white people have as the African American experience. Just being able to be around it, to witness it, and they feel the same thing with Southern themes. So I made this, you know, I had this big movie called Mother Trucker, which was based on a true story about this guy who was in jail for stealing trucks. He was a harmless guy, real lovable guy, but he had about 3 weeks left on his sentence, but his sister came to him and told him that his mama was dying and be dead within the week, so he breaks out of prison. He steals like a Walmart tractor trailer right off the back of a Walmart. He steals Crystal Gayle's tour bus, and he's all trying to get home to mama. Right. And so I had this movie where all these out-of-work truckers kind of like found out what he was doing, and they were trying to get him to mama. And so it was like, then it turns into Convoy. And so it you know, the budget was at a good place, but the Southern specificity of it, I think, scared some people.
Yeah. Did you have anybody attached to it acting wise?
We had gone out to a couple, and it's so funny that the two people that I really want, I mean, like I really felt that Wahlberg could do it, and I really also felt that McConaughey could do it. Mm-hmm. And at the time, they both were kind of like not necessarily as hot as they are now. It's right. Like pre-Fighter, pre-the McConaissance.
McConaughey was in the middle
right
of a romantic comedy or something. Yeah.
I like that. That's the first time I heard McConaissance.
He's good great. Stuff. I mean, yeah. I've always loved that guy, but it's so great that he's just blossoming.
Yeah.
But it's funny because, you know, those were two people that, you know, the studio at the time weren't necessarily crazy about. And it's funny how just things change. And so, and then after that, you know, after writing that, there was there was, you know, writing Footloose and doing Footloose, and then I was on Tarzan. And Tarzan became
that's what I was
going to
ask you. What happened with Tarzan? Where's that going?
Tarzan, I wrote the script,
yeah,
and I was attached to direct it, and then we brought in Adam Kozad to work on my script. Uh-huh. There's been a lot of confusion out there, like, because I think, you know, Adam wrote a script, and I wrote a script, and but it's essentially, you know, it's still my script. Mm-hmm. It's still my story that they're doing. The problem is that the budget just got so high.
Yeah.
I mean, and, you know, I've never done a budget that big.
And the studio doesn't trust you with it? Is that
studio,
what it is?
That's what it is.
All right, because here's... Yeah. Here,
I mean, I don't know if it's that specifically, but I think what it was is that, you know, there's another director that have made a couple of billion dollars for them, and it's time for them to maybe get something for him. Which, by the way, I kind of... understood.
Yeah, no, I mean, I get it in the business side of it too, but here's another, like, Gavin Hood, by the way, made the great film Satsi, which was awesome, and then he did another film, and then he got Wolverine Origins, and everybody hates Wolverine Origins, and from what I've heard from a bunch of different people is that Fox just bullied him on that because they could, because he didn't have the experience, so they bullied him, and he took his shots, and then he did Ender's Game. And Ender's Game, I actually thought was he felt more of his voice on there, and you felt his stamp more so than on Wolverine Origins.
Damn fine piece of cinema, yeah.
Yeah. So the question I have though too is that, do you think, because even like if you go to Christopher Nolan, when he was able to do this, he had to jump up from doing Insomnia, and then he jumped and then he was able to, they gave him Dark Knight eventually, and then that's all she wrote, or not Dark Knight, Batman Begins. Uh-huh. So you think that it's just a matter of finding that one that they give you, and then it's just, okay, now I can make whatever the fuck I want to make.
I wish I could believe that were the case. I mean, I think there's only a handful of people that can write their own ticket right now. Christopher Nolan be one. And it's funny because I don't think it's Dark Knight that did that for him.
No, Batman Begins?
No, I don't even think it was Batman Begins. I think it was Inception. Because...
That was after.
Oh, I know. But see, I really think that there's... I could be completely wrong on this. But I think that the studio still in the back of their mind thinks, well, Batman's still us.
Yeah, we knew Batman was going to make money, too.
Yeah, it's Batman.
I see what you're saying. Yeah,
But then he comes along with this thing where it's like, wait a minute, what are you doing?
No, dude, it's like a dream in a dream.
Yeah, and they're right? They're like, well, it's not, but listen, you know, Christopher, that's not going to make Batman numbers. But then it made Batman numbers.
Right.
And they were like, okay, whatever you're gonna,
whatever he's doing. Yeah, I think that added to it for sure. But I mean, there's just something again. I mean, I guess it's a totally different conversation in regards to what he did too. But it's the fact that what I loved about what he could do, he can tell them to back off, regardless of what, because he still has the numbers, regardless if it's Batman or not. He was the director. He was in the helm. He was the one that made that work. Same way Tim Burton was for the first two films, and the power comes from that. And he's able to do Inception. He's able to tell them to back off because, look, my movie made money.
Yeah, the only thing I would say is that, and maybe I shouldn't be saying this because it's kind of, you know, destroying a little bit of the mystique around directors. But you'd be surprised how much studios are still up in their grill.
Yeah.
I mean, Michael Bay, Christopher Nolan, and also...
I think they should be in Michael Bay's grill.
Well, but they also should be in Christopher Nolan's grill, too.
Yeah.
Because it's that give and take, I think, that sometimes yields a better product. I mean, I've heard plenty of horror stories where I've heard what the director, who did a great job with it, was going to do.
Right.
And then it's like, oh, somebody talked him out of that.
Yeah, it's a collaborative process. Sure. But what I like about a filmmaker like Craig is that it doesn't seem like you're going to be the guy that's going to take a lot of shit from a studio.
Right.
You seem to be the guy that's going to be like, oh, you want to replace barbecue with sushi? Then we're not making the movie anymore.
Yeah.
You know, you seem like you're going to want to make the film the way you make mm-hmm. it, and you can tell everybody else to F off. Is that what you're doing here in L.A. right now? You just tell a bunch of people to go jump in a lake?
Here's what's really hard is that I do get offered movies that I turn down, and sometimes they are big movies, but I do know
did
that
did you get offered the remake of Roadhouse?
I did not.
We need you on that one. Yeah, Greg,
I did not. I think he's going to do a good job.
Okay.
I think he's going to do a good job.
We'll
I could see it together.
It'll be a date.
Yeah.
No, right? But I mean, it's a tricky business out there. I mean, the thing is that here you all are talking about Roadhouse, and I know that you guys, you know, you review plenty of movies that people have never heard of, but it's just that pre-recognition. I mean, already there's a debate about Roadhouse. This movie hasn't even probably been scripted.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, and we're talking about it.
Yeah.
That's why these remakes get made.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, for me, I just got to connect to it. And if I don't connect to it, then I don't want to spend 2 years of my life waking up at 5 a.m. in the morning with dry heaves and worrying all myself to death.
Is there a certain genre? Like, let's say someone tomorrow, like, there's a good collaboration. There's a good, because I agree with you that you have to have the back and forth. Because I worked at Warner Brothers for like almost 3 years, and like, you have to have that executive that gets it. There are plenty that don't, but there are those guys that go, "Oh, that's great. What if you do this?" And the director will work with them, and you're right, a better product happens. If that dream executive worked with you and said, okay, here's your genre, what genre would you want to work at in the big spectrum?
A monster movie.
Monster movie? Oh, awesome. Yeah.
Okay, but a monster movie that really kind of like gets into at least what I felt like I was exploring with Black Snake Moan, which is like, okay, when you look at the big creature, whether it be the, you know, Black Lagoon or Kong, or and they've got like that woman that's just completely like just passed out in their arms, and they just look gorgeous in this hulking. Yeah. I've always been attracted to what that's about. There's something going on there.
He
on
can't
both
physically
sides.
Put it in her. It's what, like, right. What do you even?
No, I know. Yeah. And that's what makes it kind of.
It doesn't fit, Kong.
That's what makes it kind of cool. You know what I mean? Oh, that's what God. Makes
he
it
He wants
like,
to make
what?
A creature. Okay, how about this?
What? Swamp Thing?
Yeah, what? Swamp Thing?
Nah, see, I went to. I
perfect
really
for you.
Wanted to do Swamp Thing. Yeah. I had a whole pitch on Swamp Thing. I just don't think that Warner's making Swamp Thing.
Or a Sasquatch. You know, the Sasquatch thing is coming back with this show on Animal Planet. You know? Memphis, I believe there's a Sasquatch like somewhere in Tennessee in the mountains. You ever driven in the mountains of Tennessee?
His name's Roy.
But Swamp Thing
he was the grip on the 400.
Yeah. Swamp Thing and Sasquatch save Christmas. Do that one.
Let's save a holiday. Save a holiday, Craig. That's what the kids want to see.
A monster movie with some sex in it. And I don't mean actual boning. I mean like it's just steamy, and it's muddy and ugly, and yet there's just something that you're like, I can't stop watching this. Right. There's something a little hot about this.
Well, how are you feeling about it?
Oh, yeah.
Are you excited? Are you excited for the Godzilla remake?
Yeah, I mean, because look, now I'm a dad, and so like, if there's ever an opportunity where I can take my son to a movie and just go, okay, look, we're gonna watch this, and then we're gonna go, because I'll give you a perfect example. My kids love the original Clash of the Titans.
Oh wow!
And when they
good kids,
when they have a choice,
yeah,
they will watch the original Clash of Titans.
Wow!
And they love Wrath of the Titans and all that kind of stuff.
What's the trick? How do you get them to like the original with all the cool special effects? Because my daughter's two. I'm going to start showing her the old school stuff first. Is that what you did?
Yeah,
I'm going to show her Roadhouse.
You just got to show her that. Let me tell you this story. You'll really appreciate the story. Yeah. Okay, so I got a 12-year-old boy. I got a 5-year-old girl. So we tell the kid at the end of the night, you know, my wife and I, we want to like, you know, finally get them down. I don't know if y'all have kids, but it's like there's this moment where you get
Erin
them.
And I are still talking about it.
When you get them down, there's this victory. You just want to get drunk with your wife and just fall asleep.
Right.
So we get the son situated and we go, what movie do you want to watch? He goes, I want to watch Jaws.
Nice.
And so my daughter, Ren, she says, well, I want to watch Jaws. And we're like, actually, this isn't really a movie for you. How about we set up a computer up in our bed and you can watch My Little Ponies? And she's like, okay, ponies. So we put on My Little Ponies and Jody and I, my wife, we go out onto the porch. You know, we're having some wine. It's like we're talking. Everything's good. We come back in. I hear the whistle from Jaws, like I'm hearing, like, because I know that it's that scene where like the jaw where the sharks in the little pond area with the kids, and I was like, oh, this is a cool scene. Let's go watch it. We go into the back room. An hour has gone by now, and my daughter's there, totally sprawled out, like Cheez-Its and a juice box. She's been there, you know. She's just been watching it, and I was like, Ren, what are you doing in here? And my son's like, oh, she's been here since right when you guys left. She came she came in. That's and I was awesome. Like, well, we got to go. And she was fighting me. And I said, okay, there's this one part. We are going to finally finish watching this movie. But there's this one part. I'm not going to argue with you. It's too bloody. I'm going to take you out of it. Do you guys know what part of it? It's like when the shark finally bites down on Quint.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Poor Quint.
So right when that shark jumps up on the boat, I slap my hands. I'm like, Ren, come on. Come on. And she's fighting with me for the first time in her life. She's like, no, no. And like, she just pushes her face to that screen and just watches blood as it just gushes out
of
her
mouth. Yeah.
So now we watch it all the way to the end. But I swear to God, I'm passing her room the next day. and I see her with dolls, and she's saying, "You can't close the beaches because it's the 4th of July, and we're going to have all these people. We have to close. There's a shark out there." And then my wife, she calls me while I was on set of this show that I was doing. She goes, "You won't believe what your daughter did." She asked, she's a little sick. I said, "What movie do you want to watch?" She wanted to watch Jaws. I put in Jaws, and in the blue glow of the Blu-ray menu coming into, you know, on the screen, she recites with startling clarity the "y'all know me, know how I earn a living" monologue.
Wow.
You know, she'll say it for you. She's like, "I'll find them for six, but I'll catch them and kill them for 10. For that, you get the head, the tail, the whole damn thing."
Oh, my.
And to hear it out of a 5-year-old, it's like, I just cry.
You know what, Christian? I don't give out this award that often, but if somebody has a coffee mug that says Father of the Year, it goes to Mr. Craig Brewer.
Thank you.
I watched
Jaws and Clash of the Titans.
I watched Sophia the First with my daughter yesterday. Nobody knows what that is.
Yeah. It's taking you to school.
That is incredible. No, look, you have a filmmaker on your hands is what it is, because if you're watching the Spielberg that early, man. Craig Brewer here talking about everything from Poor and the Hungry, making small films, making big films. How long do we have you for?
I'm not going anywhere.
Great, because I would love for you to stick around too, because we're gonna talk about some upcoming releases too, if you're down to do that as well.
Yeah, loan us another 20 minutes of your time.
Absolutely.
But make sure, guys, go to thepoorandhungry.com and check out Craig's movie. Again, doing it all on his own, and again, getting a lot of tweets from you guys, and I agree, very, very inspiring to hear him speak, especially if you want to make films. So we'll be right back just in a second with Craig Brewer talking upcoming releases in the theater. Schmoes No Movies.
Listening to the Toadhop Network, radio worth watching.
What's up, Toadheads? Hey, make sure you check out the Toadhop store on toadhopnetwork.com. It's a great way to support the network and helps continue to bring you quality programming.
Quality programming, my ass.
Can you see I'm recording, you a-hole?
So maybe you've got a great idea for a business and want to start selling your products or services online. Maybe you're an established business owner looking for new customers. Or maybe you're interested in starting a personal website. No matter who you are, GoDaddy wants to help you kick ass online. Right now, GoDaddy's offering .com domains for just $1.99. It's go time. Start your website today. Visit GoDaddy.com and enter promo code TOAD to get your $1.99.com or click on the GoDaddy graphic on the Toadhop website. Some limitations apply. See website for details.
Is that hunk of junk you call a car always breaking down and leaving you in the dust? Log on to Dyson-Motors.com and check out Dyson's full inventory online. With hundreds of quality cars in stock of all makes and models, you can find the next car of your dreams in minutes. And know you're getting super low pricing. Purchase a car today from Dyson Motors and receive a year of free oil changes. Bad credit? Worried about financing? Log on and get pre-approved in seconds. Go to Dyson-Motors.com and find your new car today.
What's up, everyone? Sports Guru here. Sick of looking at the same old boring websites? Well, check out the new sportsguru.com for all the hottest training videos and all the biggest sports news. Become a VIP for only $4.99 and get premium access to everything the Sports Guru has to offer. The beautiful gurus, girls, all my biggest sports picks, and much more. So get off that porn site and check out the new sportsguru.com.
To leave your house to shop, to crawl through traffic to the mall,
just to find the thing you wanted,
isn't even there at all.
Amazon.com is the answer.
Shop at home in style and ease.
Find exactly what you want.
Ordering your stuff's a breeze.
Books on tape.
Games galore.
Everything you're looking for.
Kindle.
Cameras. Electronics.
Baby Einstein.
Hooked on phonics.
Blu-ray.
Movies.
And TV.
Download.
Music.
MP3.
Pixar.
Disney.
Microphone.
Pet supplies and doggy bones.
World of Warcraft.
Nancy Drew.
Sims.
The Scruff System too.
Click Amazon.
You'll smile with glee.
Sometimes shipping's even free.
With GameFly, choose from over 6,000 titles. Play as long as you want and send them back when you're done. $8.95 to start, no late fees. GameFly.com. Games delivered.
Live from the Toadhop Network studios
in Hollywood, this is the ToadhopNetwork.com.
Enhances the senses, opens your mind.
Radio worth watching.
Radio worth watching.
Oh, really?
I thought that I took it off the playlist, but I guess it didn't.
It's a good song for what's going on tonight. This is the end of us live in studio at this location of Toad Hop.
Yeah.
But the song, it's a great song. I love the Doors, but it's such a...
We're at peace.
It's so apocalypse now.
Well, I'd rather hear Panama.
Impressive.
Yeah.
All right.
Impressive.
It
Thank
is the Schmoes No Movie Show. Christian Harlow.
Hack into a caribou, you know, with lightning and...
Some blood.
That's what we got the interns to do. Yeah. So we're here. It's Schmoes No Movies. We're here with myself, Mark Ellis, Erin Darling, and director Craig Brewer. And now we are going to be doing some really cool stuff coming up here. As you guys know, we have the Schmoes No Network that is going to be starting. We have the Schmoes No Movie Show that we're doing right now, which will be, again, on Toad Hop every Thursday night, just like it is now. Just you will have an hour show instead of a two-hour show and a lot of really cool guests. But one of the really cool things that we're doing, we're working with Drama 3-4, really great production company, and we are going to be doing a movie of like short movies.
It's kind of like a film festival, but it's not, you know, film festival sounds like an all-day thing, and we're not going to have cotton candy
Two shows.
It's movie night.
Movie night, that's right. That's a perfect way to put it. It's a movie night with Schmoes No and Drama 3-4, and what it is they found a lot of really funny little internet shorts, and we're going to be airing them on at the La Brea, where is that?
Acme Comedy Theater on La Brea and Beverly. There's two shows on Friday night, December the 6th, 8 and 10:30.
8 and 10 p.m. And you guys can go to $10 for the tickets, and it's going to be a lot of fun. And we are going to be debuting the first short that we did with Drama 3-4. It's going to be a lot of fun. So if you're in Los Angeles, go to the Acme Comedy Theater, buy the tickets. It's going to be a lot of fun. And some of your Schmoes No crew will be there as well. So
oh my God, live in person?
Yep. So
holy shit.
Holy shit balls indeed. All right, before we get into the current releases, I want to take a phone call from Schmoeville, and let's get to the lines. Hey, you're in Schmoeville, who do we got?
Hey, it's George.
Georgie, what's up,
Georgie.
Man? You know, Georgie, you are an aspiring filmmaker. Now, do you have any questions for Craig?
Yes, I do. I have a big question. First of all, Mr. Brewer, it's a pleasure talking to you. As an aspiring filmmaker and being young and whatnot, I know, so you made Before and the Hungry basically by yourself, from what it sounds like. Do you think at this point in this day and age that's still a viable option, just to go out, basically find locations on your own, have material you've come up with and have faith in, and just kind of just do it and get it done, so to speak? Is that still a viable option?
Oh, yeah. If anything, it's easier. I mean, now everybody has... I mean, let me be clear of what's easy. I mean... Technology's at a point now where people can film incredible images with, you know, cameras that are a couple of grand, or they can rent something. You now can edit on your laptop computer. I had to edit my movie. I had 2 9 and 2 18 gig drives, which means it only held 2 hours of footage. So I had to edit every 10 minutes and then delete all the footage that made that 10 minutes after I dumped that to tape, and then just kind of daisy chain it all together. So I guess what I'm getting at, though, is that why I think it's important is there's nothing probably worse in the industry than you not figuring yourself out in time. And what I mean by that is that once you're on their dime, you can't figure yourself out. And if you, I don't want to say have missteps, but I mean, if you have something that's kind of specifically your vision and it doesn't gel with financiers or whoever, then, you know, they're going to punish you for it. And I think there's a lot of falling down that has to happen in order for you to learn and in order for you to figure yourself out. And I mean, I always bring about, there's two examples, one which is about rock and roll, the other is about Robert Rodriguez. In rock and roll, Ike Turner, he's driving up with his band to Memphis, Tennessee,
B.B. King told him there's this white man named Sam Phillips recording a bunch of musicians. They get pulled over by a cop, and the amplifier falls off the car, and it busts the amplifier tube. So they go into the studio, and they're like, we totally messed up this amp. Sam Phillips then takes that amp, and he pushes a bunch of newspaper into it, and it has a certain distortion, and they call that the first rock and roll song, Rocket 88. Then you've got Robert Rodriguez, right? And he's got a camera that is on El Mariachi that sounds like a machine gun when it goes off. I mean, it's really, really noisy. And so what he would do is he would film these scenes, and then he would go into his car with an audio recorder, and he would say, okay, repeat your lines. And then they would record the lines. Now, if you've done anything with editing, you probably know what's going to happen. He'd sync it up, but then it eventually would go out of sync. So what would he do to cover that up? He would cut to the dog looking one way or the other. He would cut to reaction shots. Now Robert's got all the money in the world, but that style, though, was created. And that feel that Robert, I mean, you can watch a Robert Rodriguez movie now, and with the cuts, you're like, man, I'm watching a Robert Rodriguez movie without even knowing it.
Right.
So I think that it's not only I don't want to say it's easy, because it's going to be very, very hard for you to go out there and do it, but it's so necessary for you to do it. It's so important.
You got to get out there and experiment, and try to fall down the stairs and land on your feet. And bust some amplifiers.
And Georgia, because you've been such a fantastic caller through all the last 2 years that we've been doing the live show, you got anything else for Craig you want to ask before I let you go?
Just, do you have any other advice, man, as far as writing and directing, other than just go do it? Yeah, I mean, I guess the first thing I would say is that, okay, so I got friends that sometimes they'll want to write a movie that it's genre. It's got, like, explosions and shit like that in it. But they never quite get the budget, to make that explosion look incredible. The way you make that scene work is you don't write the explosion. You write something. You get like three collaborators, three people that you think are really, really good that are going to be there for you. And you figure something out with that. I mean, you could do a double feature of Breakfast Club and Reservoir Dogs. And people go, what? And the reason is that it's still five or six people in one room. And a lot of drama comes out of that. And so I would just recommend there's times that people, they write really big and then they try to go out and make that by hook or crook. And it kind of falls short of their expectations because I think they wrote too big for what they're doing. And really, you should be able, for the rest of your life as a filmmaker, be able to have two people that come over to your apartment and go, you know what, we're going to do something and it's going to be 10 minutes long and it's not going to involve any dialogue. What can I do? If those were my limitations, what kind of film could I make with that? And people, the first thing that's always going to pop into people's head is like, yeah, but is that really going to get me in the door? Is that really going to get me that contract? And you can't worry about that. It's one of the things that my dad said before he died. He was like, it sounds to me like you're worried about getting in the business and you're not worried about getting good. And he was right. And he totally called me out on it.
Yeah.
So I would just recommend you just, you do as much as you can with friends that aren't going to turn their back on you later, because it is going to be abusive. Making movies are just abusive. I don't know. I mean, we love it, and that's why we keep doing it. But it's still really hard to do, especially if you got other jobs. And I know what that's like, and I understand it. But consider yourself part of like a long line of artists, who've had to suffer and also have like many sleepless nights wondering if the thing that they're making is any good or not.
All right, Georgie, there you go, bud.
Yeah,
not a peep. Georgie, thank you so much. Yeah, not a peep from anybody in this
room.
See,
that was really, always the problem. Yeah. Now that he brings it up, that was always the problem with the movies that me and my brother wanted to make when we were kids, is the end, the script always had our house blowing up. And it was my parents just stifling our creativity. Yeah. They said, we're not moving today.
Yeah, you got to go back.
Yeah.
All right, that's awesome. So we have about like 10 minutes to talk about the current releases coming out, too, because what I want to do, I want to get kind of everybody's take of the movies that are coming out, which one kind of speaks to them as a film goer, or, what they are looking forward to this week, if they're going to see anything, and what they think about it overall.
Yeah, so I think you kick off with a big one this week. You have children. You have a kid. My kids are -2 and -3. I am going to think, but you say that, and you're like, oh, okay, Frozen is just going to be a movie for the kids, for the families.
Yeah.
I saw this movie as a single adult male, and I loved it. I fell in love with this movie. It felt like the classic Disney tone that's been missing in theaters for a while, and just in case case you're not into all that princesses stuff, Olaf the Snowman is one of the best comedic sidekicks
in a long, long time.
I love
time.
That name, too.
Olaf, yeah.
Olaf the Snowman. Have you, because Erin, you know a lot of Hollywood people. You get into screenings. Did you see Frozen yet?
I haven't seen it yet, okay. But I've heard rave reviews from my AMC friends.
Well, Craig, I know, obviously, it's a Jaws household, but are they into the Disney movies at all?
Okay. Oh, yeah. We're going to be there.
Listen, this movie, what I liked about it, and again, without giving anything away about the actual plot of it, it just has that feel that the Disney magic used to have. Like, Wreck-It Ralph was a good movie, for sure. I really liked that movie a lot.
Me too.
So good.
But something along the lines of, it just makes you feel like you're watching the Disney magic again, you know, just to repeat myself. But it's just, there was something different when you were there, when you're watching it. I'm like, oh, they're back to form here.
Can you take your daughter to? What's your daughter, like, two?
She's two. And I actually, see,
that's
I don't think.
That's tricky.
It's tricky.
I got a thought on that.
Yeah.
You got to just agree that you're going to just show them the movie like 20 minutes and then go.
That's exactly
you gotta
right.
You
got
to just be okay with it.
And you got to pick that game.
Because you're going to be that guy. That guy that, like, when you were a single dude and you'd see a parent bring their kid. I was at a midnight screening, Thursday midnight. Oh, you remember that movie, The Immortals?
Oh, yeah.
Came out. There was a baby. In The Immortals. Yeah, no. Midnight. And everybody's looking at it like, what kind of
now, my daughter's really active, too. She'll be like me when I was two. My dad took me. I was running up and down the aisles. And it's just like you said. Then I'm the guy going, come on. Asshole, get your kid out of here.
Yeah, well, that'll be me.
So no, but she, I will buy her the Blu-ray absolutely when it comes up, because that will be my wife's gonna be like, oh, she's getting bored of Sophia. I got Frozen.
Oh, I bought Little Mermaid today.
Oh,
Target. It's on Blu-ray.
Yeah.
Do they keep the scene where the priest gets a boner at the end?
No, they got rid of it.
They got rid of it
entirely, or they edited out the boner.
Well, they just reworked it. But
I'm sorry if when the little mermaid comes up, that's the first thing that pops into my head.
Those poor animators had no idea that technology would get to a point where we could freeze frame everything. On the animation and see their boners.
That's right. Not right. About Frozen, it's because Frozen, it's like the joke is pretty ripe for a Walt Disney's Frozen body joke.
Yeah.
not even a.
Well, you know, we're talking remakes, and another remake that comes out this week is Old Boy. Now, what do you guys
think about that?
I want to get your take on this first, because we saw it. because I'm curious. But from someone who's made, someone who has, again, comes from the.
You've seen it?
We've seen it.
Ooh.
Yeah.
We're poker facing it right now.
We haven't done a review on it yet.
Well, I love anything Spike does, really. Like, I'm a huge fan of his.
When I heard
he was doing Old Boy, I was like, my God, how is he going to put up with the fanboy talk on that? Because Old Boy is like, it's legendary amongst us. Like, it's that thing that none of us saw it in a theater. Let's be honest, right? None of us really saw Old Boy. It's that thing that somebody told you, no, you got to get this DVD or you got to get this import.
Right.
Figure out a way to do it. When I was filming Black Snake Moan, like Sam was talking to me about Korean cinema and everything, and then finally, like, he's a fanatic over that movie. I mean, he watches Old Boy over and over and over.
Old Boy was always the one that the video store clerks in your hometown would be like, oh, you haven't seen Old Boy?
Yeah.
I can't converse with you about so film.
When it's kind of like the Battle Royale. It kind of replaced Battle Royale.
Did he have anything to do with it getting, that Spike, you know, him and Spike working on it, like, together? Or
I heard that, you know, they hadn't worked with each other for years. Mm-hmm. I don't know if it's a falling out or tension. I know that definitely they've said, you know, because, you know, Spike has been critical of Quentin's movies and Sam would kind of defend Quentin. And so, I don't know, but I hear that their wives are really good friends.
Okay.
And so they would still connect that way. But I'm sure that once Sam heard that Spike was doing Old Boy, he was like, you're putting me in that.
Right.
Wow. I'm really, I guess I'll have to wait till.
Yeah, we can't even, they have an embargo on it. We can't really talk about it until it. Like.
Oh, really?
Yeah, we can't even mention anything.
We
about
can't
it.
Even like a series of like third base coach.
No, we can tell you after the break if you want, but we can't say anything now. But
I haven't seen it yet either. But
have
I'm
you seen
excited.
Old Boy, the first one?
Yeah, that and Chunking Express are my favorite import movies.
I love Chunking
Good
Express.
One.
So what do you say? Are you excited for Old
I'm
Boy?
I'm excited, but I'm not expecting much.
Okay.
I'll be honest.
Okay.
My bar is pretty low, but I'm super interested to see how the interpretation is, because I heard it's nothing like the original. And I really like the original, but that doesn't mean that I won't like the new one. I'm just a little bit hesitant.
Right. I think that's the way to go
see
into
how
it.
Me too.
Yeah,
it.
You want to go into any remake kind of like that, where you try to get away from the expectations of what you had with the original because it could be so different. But so have fun watching it, guys.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, boy.
Call us when you catch up, losers.
And then you got another one, and that's going to be.
It's another kind of.
kind of
It was originally supposed to be Rambo 5. Yeah. And then they reworked the script, and now it's Homefront, and that's with Jason Statham.
Oh, right.
And Winona Ryder and Kate Bosworth, which we can talk about. That review is going to be out tonight, I think, right?
And James Franco is also.
Yeah, James Franco, right. Yeah. Look, it reminded me of Walking Tall in a certain aspect too.
Also remade.
It's true. But I how do you feel about Statham movies overall?
I like him.
Yeah.
He does what he does perfectly, I think. I liked what was that I guess they're all heist movies. The Job movie,
the Italian Job.
Bank
Job.
Italian Job.
Love the Bank Job.
Yeah,
the Bank
Job. Love the Bank
Job.
Good movie.
Great movie.
Good movie. Kind of transcends his other movies.
And I mean, it's like a movie. It's a very different from what he normally does too. In nice, because we saw that when we first started reviewing movies, and we were like, because we were expecting just another. Well, it was clever.
Yeah,
everything worked really well. By the way, guys, if you have not seen The Bank Job, if it's on Netflix, check it out.
Because
it's worth it.
Statham has real chops. Like when you'd watch these early '90s action films, which is what Homefront feels a lot like, and you'd see like Steven Seagal. God love him and his ponytail, but you're like, man, I hope he can pull off these lines. Statham, you almost feel like he's a little boxed in by the material, and he can't really. But in Homefront, like what Christian said in our review, is that there is a more dramatic element, and you're watching the movie, and some of you is like, yeah, it's a little more dramatic. Or they just didn't make another action scene. But the action that's in this is cool, and it feels realistic, and I thought it was cool.
I think it's a good rental.
Statham's my guy.
Homefront's a movie that I think the studio just gave up on. Like, where is the promotion happening for this? Where's the vehicle behind this movie? I feel like it just exists and nobody knows about it.
Yeah, and I think it's getting buried it's going up against Hunger Games in the second week. It's going up against Frozen. I think at this point they go, the fan base that's going to see it is going to see it, and they're not really doing a big push.
Homefront is like those candied yams that your aunt makes for Thanksgiving, and it's just let them sit over in the corner. Let's act like we all put one on our
maybe
plate.
Maybe after I eat all the good stuff.
Yeah. So, out of all the movies that are coming out, and that can be something that was in last week or maybe something you haven't seen, is there anything that you guys, Craig, that you're looking forward to seeing that you haven't seen that you want to see, or something that you've seen that you really enjoyed?
You know, I mean, the two movies I think that have impressed me the most this year, one which was bigger than life, which was Gravity. I really liked Gravity.
Loved it. Yeah.
My wife really loved Gravity. Like, it's one of those movies that I'm sure, like, I could take, like, my old, you know, aunts and uncles too. They would love it, and still, like, my son would love it.
Mm-hmm.
But Nebraska.
Oh, did you really like it?
I don't. But maybe it's just me because I loved it. I was so moved by that movie.
Okay.
And so I thought it was funny. I thought it was delightful. And but I'm kind of that way with, like, just old men just make me weepy.
Did you think the second half was stronger than the first?
You know, I think what it was is that the first half was so Alexander Payne weirdness,
yeah.
And I kind of enjoyed that. But the second half, I was just so with them. I felt that if Will Forte, it is Will Forte, right?
Yeah, Will Forte. He's right there.
I felt that if, like, he had not been on Saturday Night Live and he just came out of nowhere, people would be hailing him as, like, who is this actor?
Yeah.
He's so good.
He was good, too, and I was nervous about him, again, because of exactly what you said. You see the Saturday Night Live, you're like, I wonder if he's out of his element here, and he was, and he was fantastic.
Yeah, you know, I was a little nervous coming to this interview tonight because it's always cool to get to talk to somebody you really admire, you really, you know, respect, and that is exactly what we got to do tonight with Mr. Craig Brewer. Definitely check out thepoorandhungry.com where you can get the film on Blu-ray and get posters, a bunch of cool extra stuff.
Yeah.
Or you can get it free digital download if you're going to be a cheapskate about it.
That's right. And when you are back in LA and we're at our new studio, please come back and visit.
I'd love to.
It was really great having you in the studio. Guys, check him out. Also on Twitter, MyBrewTube. All right. So for Schmoes New Movies, we'll be back with Kellen Coleman playing Celebrity Impression Dating Game. Craig Brewer in studio. Christian Harloff, Mark Ellis, Erin Darling.
You're listening to the Toadhop Network, radio worth watching.
What's up, Toadheads? Hey, make sure you check out the Toadhop store on ToadhopNetwork.com. It's a great way to support the network and helps continue to bring you quality programming.
Quality programming, my ass.
Can you see I'm recording, you a**hole?
So maybe you've got a great idea for a business and want to start selling your products or services online. Maybe you're an established business owner looking for new customers. Or maybe you're interested in starting a personal website. No matter who you are, GoDaddy wants to help you kick ass online. Right now, GoDaddy's offering .com domains for just $1.99. It's go time. Start your website today. Visit GoDaddy.com and enter promo code TOAD to get your $1.99.com or click on the GoDaddy graphic on the Toadhop website. Some limitations apply. See website for details.
What's up, everyone? Sports Guru here. Sick of looking at the same old boring websites? Well, check out the new sportsguru.com for all the hottest trending videos and all the biggest sports news. Become a VIP for only $4.99 and get premium access to everything the Sports Guru has to offer. The beautiful gurus, girls, all my biggest sports picks, and much more. So get off that porn site and check out the new sportsguru.com.
Is that hunk of junk you call a car always breaking down and leaving you in the dust? Log on to Dyson-Motors.com and check out Dyson's full inventory online. With hundreds of quality cars in stock of all makes and models, you can find the next car of your dreams in minutes. And know you're getting super low pricing. Purchase a car today from Dyson Motors and receive a year of free oil changes. Bad credit? Worried about financing? Log on and get pre-approved in seconds. Go to Dyson-Motors.com and find your new car today.
Does your car smell like... You need Scent Bomb. Does your house smell like... Get some Scent Bomb. Does the bathroom smell like... Get some Scent Bomb. Go to GetSomeScentBomb.com today for the best air freshener you've ever tried. We are so confident that you will love Scent Bomb that we're giving away a free bottle to the next 12 customers to type in the promo code RADIO at checkout. If you're tired of weak air fresheners, try Scent Bomb. Scent Bomb is a concentrated air freshener, so all you need is just a couple of sprays and the smell will last for days. That's right, you spray it today and you still smell it tomorrow. We guarantee that it's the best air freshener you've ever tried. So go to GetSomeScentBomb.com and enter the promo code RADIO at checkout to get your free bottle today. There's nearly 100 fragrances to choose from, so go to GetSomeScentBomb.com. That's GetSomeScentBomb.com.
To leave your house to shop, to crawl through traffic to the mall.
Just to find the thing you wanted.
Isn't even there at all.
Amazon.com is the answer.
Shop at home in style and ease.
Find exactly what you want.
Ordering your stuff's a breeze.
Books on tape.
Games galore.
Everything you're looking for.
Kindle. Cameras. Electronics.
Baby Einstein.
Hooked on phonics.
Blu-ray.
Movies.
And TV.
Download.
Music.
MP3.
Pixar.
Disney.
Microphones.
Pet supplies and doggy bones.
World of Warcraft.
Nancy Drew.
Sims.
The Scruff System too.
Click Amazon.
You'll smile with glee.
Sometimes shipping's even free.
With GameFly, choose from over 6,000 titles. Play as long as you want and send them back when you're done. $8.95 to start, no late fees. GameFly.com, games delivered.
You're listening to the Toad Hop Network, radio worth watching.
It is the Schmoes No Movies podcast. We are not down in Louisiana, not close to New Orleans. We are out in Los Angeles, and it's our last time in the Hollywood studios of Toad Hop. It's very emotional here. I'm Mark Ellis. Over there is Christian Harloff. Sitting in for Tiffany Smith is lovely Erin Darling. And you know, Christian, the holiday season is a time of giving, and what better gift to give than the gift of laughter? And you can pick up my kind of new CD, Mark Ellis, Get to the Castle, on iTunes and Amazon, hard copy and digital download.
Good gift.
1 hour stand up.
It's a good gift.
Yeah, it's $10. Bucks. It's $9.99 online.
It's really good, guys. And as much as even though we bicker and call each other names, I will always say that Mark Ellis is one of the funniest guys out there. You should go check out the CD.
Oh, I'm blushing like a little girl.
As you should. guys, it is the last live show here at Toadhop Studios. But again, like we said, make sure you go and you subscribe to the iTunes feed of the Schmoes No Network and keep the same feed that you have for this show, as it will be on every Thursday on this very website, toadhopnetwork.com.
Yes, but it is Monday tonight. Our last show is on Monday. Right. And by the way, congratulations to our co-host, Erin Darling's 49ers, who kicked the shit out of my Washington Redskins 27-6. Right. What are we going to do? And that's a great segue. a fellow Marylandite like myself, she is lovely. She is talented. And it's the first time I got to meet her.
Yeah. Oh, that's true. That's so right. True.
It's Kellen Coleman, everybody.
Hello.
And Kellen Coleman, by the way, is a woman of her word. She came in, when we were here, she said, I want to play the celebrity impression dating
Boom.
Game. The next day, we sent her a message and said, how about this date?
The next day.
We did.
You're supposed to wait like 2 days to play it cool, right?
I sent my people to go the next day. I said, can't miss out. You can't miss out on Kellen Coleman playing the celebrity impression dating
That didn't come off as desperate to you?
This it did.
Not at all.
Okay, cool.
I really meant it.
You give a guy,
I'm working my way up to co-host.
You give a guy
right
your
now.
Number and you want to call the next day. You're not one of these.
I mean,
let
that's
me wait
the point,
3 days.
Right?
Yeah. Okay.
Call me when you get home for real.
Just doing research here.
That's the darn point. Now, you give someone your number.
That's absolutely right. Now, yep. Kellen, so have you? So you know you're aware of how this game is played.
I am.
Okay. So you have not watched an episode of this show yet. Okay. Now, her reasoning was good. What was your reasoning before?
Because I was afraid that what if you do the same impressions?
And then you'll know right away who's who.
It spoils it. I also know who's who. Mm-hmm. I thought I should leave it a blank canvas and just be surprised by the hilarity.
I think that is smart. And this is the 7th episode of the Celebrity Impression Dating.
My God, it's starting to get like Super
played?
Bowls.
Who has played here?
We've all competed, and there's been a number of different winners in the room. Yeah. So it really is kind of like returning champions. I believe this is Erin Darling, who's sitting next to you, actually was in your position a few months ago. She was the contestant, and now Erin Darling is going to try her hand on the other side of the docket.
And I'm not going to know which one she is.
Yeah, no, not at all. The way the game is played,
she does an impression.
Yeah, she does a great Mark Ellis impression too. So. All right, so again, you know, now it's 9:38. I think that we should do for the last time here. I think we got to give away a free rip shirt to Schmoeville and let them play along with us.
Okay.
Because it is
someone else out there is going
to
play.
No. What they do is they get to pick. What we're going to do is we'll take phone calls at 323-622-8623. Real quick, I'm going to ask you guys, who do you have? Who you're going to play with? And if that person wins, if Kellen picks that person, then you guys will win a free Ripped Apparel t-shirt. So real quick, I'm just going to ask you who you got. Know who you got right away. All right. All right, Ken, you ready to write down some names? Okay. You're in Schmoeville. Who do we got?
It's Jerry Silvera.
Who do you got?
Good kid.
I got the most beautiful man in that room.
Mark Riley. Jerry Savella has Mark Riley. All right. Okay. Jerry Savella, Mark Riley. All
right.
Okay. You're in Schmoeville. Who do we got?
It's Haroon Taylor from California.
What was the first name?
Haroon, H-A-R-U-N.
Okay, Haroon. So who do you got?
Did anyone pick you yet?
No one picked me yet.
Okay, I got you.
Okay, Haroon's with me. That would have been awkward if he was like, guys,
this
still
is
don't want
gym
you.
Gym class all over again.
Yeah, that's it. Hey, you're in Schmoeville. Who do we got?
Hey, guys, it's Alex Welch.
All right, Alex, so who you got?
I'm going to go with, has Ellis been picked yet?
No, he has not.
I'm not picking Ellis.
All right.
All right.
Alex Welch has
Ellis.
You will
Ellis. Not regret it, Alex. Let's get you a T-shirt.
Okay, let's go. Uh-oh. Oh, no.
Every time you last.
Hey, you're in Schmoeville. Who do we got?
He's a nice guy.
Okay, Stuart from Hawaii.
Who do you got, brother?
I got Mr. Makuga.
Yeah! Mr. Makuga, hey, all right.
Way to go.
Not last.
God,
you are wearing a pink shirt, though.
God help you. All right. Hey, you're in Schmoeville. Who do we got?
And you got Matt Brown here.
Matt Brown. Let me guess. You got JTI?
Who's left?
You got JTI, Cobster, Ken Knapsack, Erin Darling. That's it.
Take Kenny.
You got Kenny. Okay. There you go.
All right.
So
not the choice I would have made, but God bless you, Matt.
All right. Again, guys, calling 323-622-8623. Hey, you're in Schmoeville. Who do we got?
Chris Williams.
You have JTI, Cobster, or Erin Darling?
We'll go with Cobster.
Okay.
It's down to Darling and JTI.
Am I about to be the nerdy kid in school? It's like the last one to be on the team.
Maybe. Well, you're the new kid in the block, so.
Yeah.
All right. Hey, you're in Schmoeville. Who do we got? JTI is pretty terrible, though, so you might get hello. All right, who do we got?
He said his A work is a C plus.
This is Andrea.
Andrea, so who do you got, brother? You got JTI or Erin Darling?
Oh, Lord knows I don't have JTI.
You got JTI? Oh, you don't want JTI?
No.
All right. You got Erin.
I'll take Erin.
All right, you got Erin. Okay.
Thank
you.
No.
Luke. All right. So now we have who is the sad sack to get stuck with JTI? Hey, you're in Schmoeville. Who do we got?
Oh, it's Leanne from New Jersey. I don't think it's a sad sack getting JTI.
You got JTI, Leanne.
We love you, Leanne. Enjoy the swamps in New Jersey.
Right. Come on, Josh.
All right,
for me. All right.
You know that's not going to happen. Okay, so Johnny Ice, let's get cracking.
Okay, now, we have a certain order we need to do. And Kellen, you will hear the voices of either me or Christian introducing the contestants. But what we need from you before you turn around and don't look over here is, what is the first question? For the first round, what would you like to ask your potential suitors?
Oh.
Question number one.
Okay. My first question is a typical question for dating. I think it's very important. What is, okay, pertaining to me, what would our first date be like?
All right, there you go. There you go. Bachelor's, bachelorette. There you have your.
All right, now does she have a blindfold? What is.
She's going to turn around and close her eyes and make sure that. Now, the way we're going to run this to the Bachelor Bachelorette is the way you got eliminated last time, or if you're new, you have to go first.
That's no, you just told her that now you got to throw her in the middle.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Well, obviously, she's got a woman's voice. She's going to know who it is.
Hey, all right. Stop it.
All right, here we go. All right, so contestant number one.
Come on, contestant number one.
Jeez. Well, hello there, Kellen. This is John F. Kennedy, America's 35th. President, our first date would look a lot like this. I'll have a Secret Service come and pick you up there at your hotel room, probably the Watergate Hotel. And we'd bring you back to the White House, and I'd have my chef cook you up some lobster, perhaps, you know, some chowder, as well as some beers there. And then we would make sweet, passionate love in the Lincoln bedroom. I am a hell of a lover. Date. Just ask Marilyn Monroe.
Contestant number two.
Hi, this is Sarah Silverman, and we, on our first date, would go to the park, or maybe we'd just park and see what happens in the car.
That was a good one, JTI. Contestant number three.
Hoo-ah! How's it going, Al Pacino? Well, first thing I'm going to do, I'm going to run out of the theater. We're going to go over there. I'm going to... let me see. Oh, sorry, I've been drinking a lot of alcohol. First thing I'm going to do, I'm going to perform The Merchant of Venice on a stage. Jesus. One-man stage. Then we're going to get some more liquor. We'll go back to my place. We're going to watch Jack and Jill all night and laugh ourselves silly. Oh, God. Can't wait. Oh,
contestant number four.
Hello, children. This is the chef from South Park. Where would I take you? Well, it depends. I'd probably take you somewhere where we could go singing and dancing and you could play with my meatballs because I like to cook. Do you like to cook? And by the way, I love the newsroom. Let's make some news in them loving. What?
So contestant shy. Number five.
Good evening, and what can I tell you? It's I, Captain Hairdo Kellen Dennis Miller. What will our first date be like? I'm going to take you in my 1978 Nova. We're going to get a raspberry phosphate like we're two kids in the 50s, celebrating our blooming love, all right? Then we'll head to a Waffle House and have a heap and plate of failure, all right?
My cheeks hurt.
Contestant number six.
Hey, how you doing over there? It's me, Mark Wahlberg. Can't you tell by the lack of oxygen in my voice? Anyways, if I were to take you out on a first date, I'd take you to a set of my new movie, Transformers. You know, the one with Michael Bay. It's not like there's not enough hot chicks on that movie anyways. So, say hi to your mother for me.
Contestant number seven.
This is ridiculous.
Yodi, this is. Oh, beautiful, you are. I will first pick you up in my car, a Corvette, 1976 Stingray, actually. We drive to the movies, we do. Popcorn, you will. Drinks, we will. Love, we will.
Contestant number eight.
Hello, Kellen. It's Kermit D. Frog here.
Oh, my God.
Just got out of a long-term relationship with the swine. It's in the hands of the judge now. It's not easy being green, but I think it'd be really easy getting to know you. We could go have a salad. I know girls like to keep their figure with a salad, and unless you're my previous girlfriend, who seemed to pump up from time to time, but I've moved beyond that, and I think we could be friends.
All right, that's your first round. So, Kellen, you can cut. You're going to be able to cut three people here.
Can I turn around?
No, you cannot turn around. Geez. So you can cut.
Okay, here's the rundown. Here's what we got here.
Thank you.
You have to cut three of these
people. Can you hear me?
You can either cut Dennis Miller, Sarah Silverman, Yodi, John F. Kennedy, Al Pacino, Mark Wahlberg, Kermit the Frog, or Chef from South Park. Who would you like to cut? Three of them are out of here.
Definitely going to cut Dennis Miller.
Oh man.
Wow. It's like an upset when the 79 Pirates beat the Orioles in the World Series.
Wow, Dennis Miller.
Dennis Miller is out now.
Two more.
I think I gotta get rid of Al Pacino, unfortunately.
What a shocker. Oh, shocker. JTI.
JTI. I could have learned a lot from Al Pacino.
For him, no, it doesn't. And one more.
Man. Which ones do I want to get rid of?
All potential suitors.
True.
One left. You can cut one left.
You know, I hate to do this because I'm a huge Disney fan, but Kermit.
Kermit the Frog.
Man.
All right.
Man.
So there you go. All right. So what is your question for the second round?
Oh, okay. My question for the second round is, what is a night like with you in bed?
Whoa, man. This is getting steamy.
Yep. I'm getting there.
Contestant number one.
Hey there, Kellen. It's me again, John F. Kennedy. I would just like to say that a night in the bedroom with me, I light a lot of candles. I treat the woman's body a lot like the Bay of Pigs invasion. I go in there unprepared, and I come out with everybody disappointed. Except you there, Kellen. I'd make sure that everything was taken care of and make sure that the next time we invaded Cuba, that I would be prepared. I'm not calling you Cuba, but okay, I'm going to get out of here now.
Contestant number two.
Hi, Sarah here again. I know I sound like I'm 12 years old, but in bed I've actually had a lot of practice, surprisingly, with my ex-boyfriend, Jimmy Kimmel. I don't know if you heard of him, the Aslan I talked to. So, it's going to be pretty awesome. You'll have to see.
Oh.
Contestant number three.
Hello, children. This is the chef from South Park again. What would I do? I'd probably have to sing you a song. Hey, baby, waking up in the morning with me. You're going to have to make me some special tea. Because I'll be giving you some loving. I do loving all night long. Come on, Kellen, let's do a dance to celebrate the ups and downs of our relationship. And I'm talking about sex.
Contestant number four.
In bed, you ask. Have you seen a bed levitate into the air with you on top of it? That's me. Using my mind, love making we will. Using my mind, your world rocked it will be.
Contestant number five.
Oh, man. Hey, it's me again, Mark Wahlberg. Well, did you see my movie Boogie Nights? I played Tut Diggler. Take that for your answer. It was real. Say hi to your mother for me.
And another incredible round of performances. We whittle away a few more. Kellen can.
We get rid
take
of
a breather.
Two.
Yeah, we get rid of two here.
Okay, how many are there? Five left for Anne?
There are five left. Okay. So we're going to whittle it down to three. Now, Kellen, you can choose from Chef from South Park, Sarah Silverman, Yodi, John F. Kennedy, or Mark Wahlberg.
Unfortunately, you know, I was trying to see if I could, you know, play both sides of the catcher-pitcher scenario, but apparently I can't. Sarah Silverman gotta go.
No scissoring tonight.
No scissoring.
So who was the last cut?
The last cut. Oh, man. I think it might have to be...
You can tell it's really hurting her emotionally now.
It is. Now we're getting there. Yeah. You know what? It's between a few of them. I feel like I already have a winner, too, which is horrible.
Wow. Let's face it. None of them are good.
So let's see. Chef said... What did he say? He said we could dance Horizontal Dan Mark Wahlberg,
yeah.
Dirk Diggler, you know, we know what he's got downstairs.
Prosthetic. He has a prosthetic.
Kennedy. I don't know.
This is really tough on Kellen.
It is.
Kellen, I hate to do this. I'm going to have to ask you for a final answer.
Who's your final cut?
Final answer, Chef is gone.
Oh, wow. Man.
I mean, he's a cartoon. That would be so awkward.
You think Mark Wahlberg had something special? You're missing out, baby.
All right.
Am I making upsets here? Just upsets all over the place.
All right. So, hey, did you hear what Kermit the Frog said when you voted him off?
We got to move this round along. We have eight minutes to finish this game. All right. Okay. So, your third question.
Third question is you're meeting my family for the first time. How would you treat my mother and father, and would you bring them anything, and what would it be?
Contestant number one.
Hey, it's Mark Wahlberg, in case you forgot. Anyways, well, if you saw me in the movie Ted, I bring that teddy bear. I'll give him that gift. And don't think of me of like when I was in fear, because don't think of me. I'm not like that. I'll treat him right. Say hi to your mother for me.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
That line finally worked out in his favor.
Did.
Contestant number two.
The first thing I do meeting your parents is I would make them little origami statues using my mind. That usually makes them very happy, so I can be myself with you.
An emotional Yoda.
Contestant number three.
Hey there, Kellen. It's me, John F. Kennedy, again. I would just like to say that I'm great with parents. I have two of my own, so I know how to treat parents right. I would bring your dad a bottle of scotch, because that's what I like to drink. And your mother, Jackie O, makes a hell of a pumpkin pie, and she also makes a great boysenberry pie. I would bring your parents that and my stunning, charming personality.
All right. So, Kellen, you have to cut one person. We got to do it quick so we get to the final round. Who do you cut? Do you cut JFK? Do you cut Mark Wahlberg or Yodi?
Break a heart here, Kellen.
I'm going to cut JFK.
Oh, man.
Wow.
Last question. Last question between Mark Wahlberg and Yodi.
There's going to be another question.
All right, here we go. Last question.
Okay. Oh, my God. What was my other question?
This is it. Final one. Okay, we have 6 minutes.
So your friends really want to go to the Lakers game, okay? They got tickets floor side, but you already promised me to take me to the theater. What do you do?
What do
you say to the person you let down?
Contestant number one.
Hey, baby, it's Mark Wahlberg. If you want to go to the theater, why don't you say so? I'll get front row for you because it's me. It's Mark Wahlberg. Go with any day. We can go to a Laker game any other time. Say hi to your mother for me.
Contestant number two.
Easy question, that is, to answer. I would use the Jedi mind trick on my friends. They'd not know what hit them, and you and I would drive off into the sunset.
Wow. All right, this is the moment of truth. Kellen,
oh,
you can turn around. You can turn
really
around
tough.
Now.
Yeah. Okay.
All right, so who is the winner of the celebrity impression dating game? Who wins
heart
your heart?
Palpitations all over Toadhop Network for
Kellen,
the last
your
time.
Kellen, your new sweetheart is?
In the Los Angeles studios. The answer.
Oh, this is so hard. Yodi.
Oh! Yodi! 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 This is Yodi's second win in the celebrity impression dating
game.
I brought you a double.
Yodi,
championship.
Yodi is the only to
Let
this
Let me guess
day.
Who everyone was. Wow. JFK. Yeah. Totally. I saw, so when I turned around, you must have been Mark Wahlberg.
Top star.
You were a chef.
I was chef.
Mm-hmm. He's pretty good so
Sarah
far.
Sarah Silverman, maybe.
Who was?
Yeah. What was the other one?
Do you have Dennis Miller?
Dennis Miller. Yeah. Dennis Miller?
Yeah.
And
Kermit D.
Al Pacino and
the Frog.
And Al Pacino.
Really had
JTI was terrible.
You know, Yodi though, also Disney. Now,
yeah, but
and
Kermit
a tiny
is not
man
Disney.
Who can use his
oh, yes,
mind.
He is.
So,
yeah. But I'll tell you what, when she voted JFK off, I thought the worst thing that ever happened to Kennedy was getting shot.
Oh man,
that
I thought
was
JFK,
worse.
Yeah.
His answer was very good on that one, but it was a previous answer. I kept him in as a nice thing to do because I knew he had better. He did answer better, but then I couldn't get over the answer before that.
Unbelievable. So Ken, who wins the shirt?
Joe Severa.
Okay.
Ken's like, I checked Jessica, out when Jessica. I didn't win.
Yeah, all right. So, Kellen, thank you so much for joining
us.
That was, and again, everybody's been asking, is the celebrity impression dating game going to happen in the new studio? Absolutely.
And it should happen with Kellen again.
Yeah.
Because she knows her way around the celebrity impression dating game.
I also think we should get more girls involved, and I should do an impression.
Well, that's funny you say that, because Ken Knapsack actually has a great idea. What we're going to do is we're going to do one to where it's going to be a guy as a suitor, and then all the past
girls.
Bachelorettes come back and play. As doing
impressions.
We'll do that as well. So, guys, okay, this has been the last episode, live last episode of the Schmoes Know podcast for now. You guys, make sure, check our Facebook page, facebook.com/SchmoesKnow, and Twitter and YouTube. You'll be getting all the updates as far as where the new, where it's going. What's that song playing?
All good things must come to an end, whether it's Breaking Bad or whether it's a Schmoes Know Live podcast on the Toadhop Network. Our humongous thanks to Kellen Coleman and to Craig Brewer.
And Erin Darling.
My pleasure. Thank you, guys.
Thank you so much, Erin. I think it's been a blast here at Toadhop. We want to thank everybody who's been a part of that team. We are still going to be working with you guys. Johnny Ice, we'll miss seeing you.
Johnny.
Drink yourself into oblivion on a regular basis.
That's the other thing. Johnny, I wanted to thank you for all the great shows you produced for us. Toadhop has been extremely great to us. We look forward to you guys distributing the show. Toadhop.network.com. That's where you can find all our stuff. And also, make sure you check out this Sunday night at 11 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, the Drama Queen.
Oh, boy!
Mark and I will be on the show.
We really?
Yeah, we will. This week, we'll actually be on it.
Oh, I watched it last night, and what a blast.
Yeah, so what are you doing? What are you doing?
I'm promoting our show.
Not well.
Our appearance on the Drama Queen. Kellen Coleman, your Twitter is?
At Kellen Coleman.
All right.
One Alan Kellen.
At Kellen Coleman, at Erin A. Darling, at 5150 Ellis, at Christian Harloff, at Ken Knapsack. At Josh McCouga, at Cobster, at
JTE.
JTE. Yeah. What's your new Twitter? Josh, AKA JTI, and at Riley Round.
And that's it, guys. It was a lot of fun. Look forward to talking to you guys all in Schmoeville. Peace out, mother effs. I have all of you.
Listening to the Toadhop Network, radio worth watching.